Ladies and gentlemen, welcome here to Newmarket for the English Breeding Seminar this evening. We've got some great guest speakers coming up, as well as the fantastic crew here from Inglis to really try and inform and educate you on some things that you may or may not know. I'm sure you'll get plenty out of this evening. Just a couple of little housekeeping pointers. If you can put your phones on silent, that's an obvious one, if you don't mind. And also the forms on the tables, they're basically for anybody who might be new here and hasn't been out here before or doesn't receive the catalogues from Inglis, and it's fantastic when the big sales or the small sales, just any sale at all, is coming up, and you can get those catalogues in your letterbox before it's even often out and about for people that might want to come in and pick them up. You don't need to do that. They can be sent to you. So put your name and addresses on those forms there, and you'll be able to get all the catalogues here for those of you that are new to Inglis. Jonathan Darcy, welcome to you. It's fantastic you have me here as well to be part of this, because I think it's really important to just give people a little bit more background information about how the sales operate, you know, what you're looking for with mares and stallions and weanlings and foals and all the background.
Look, absolutely, Caroline, and welcome everyone. And those of you who are looking at us online, of course, this is being streamed live on our website, so thanks for everyone who's tuning in online. Look, it is great to have so many people here tonight, and I think it's a testament to the industry that we are involved in, that so many people are interested in getting involved. I think we can certainly see a lot of new faces around the room, Caroline, and it is daunting when you first decide that you might want to go and buy a broodmare. And what we wanted to try and do tonight is take you through, you know, the first 18 months of a horse's life by talking to some of the experts in their field, you know, from buying a mare to breeding. So I'll touch on that at the start, just buying your first broodmare. And then we've got Peter Hegney, our Victorian manager, to talk a little bit about selecting a stallion to breed to. We've then got Sam Fairgrow, who spent about 15 years at Arrowfield Stud, was a manager up there for many of those years. He's now our New South Wales manager of bloodstock here at Inglis. He's going to take you through the raising of a weanling, so the importance of nutrition and things like that. We've also got Sam being joined later on by Peter O'Brien, who's the manager at Sedgenhoe Stud. He was formerly at Coolmore for many, many years. He put through some very high-priced yearlings at the recent Easter sale. And Sam and Peter are going to talk a little bit about preparing yearling for a sale, and then once you get to a sale, you know, how you present that yearling and some of the tricks of the trade there. So it's going to be interesting to hear from those two people. We've also got Chris Russell and Simon Vivian, two of our auctioneers here at Inglis. What they're going to talk to you about is what we look for when we're selecting yearlings. I mean, one of the things we want to talk about tonight, I mean, you know, we're not going to tell you how to go and breed a mare. If you're going to go and race a progeny yourself, that's your choice. But what we want to do is, if you want to breed commercially, one of the tricks is to be able to get a yearling into the yearling sales and how you can, you know, hopefully maximise your return from the yearling sales. So that's why we thought we'd put this sort of seminar on and talk about, you know, what some of the commercial aspects you've got to bear in mind when you're selecting a mare, selecting a stallion, and then producing the horse. Also tonight, we're going to hear from Dr. Jonathan Lumsden. You know, this issue about X-rays and how they play a part in our industry. So Jonathan's going to talk about not only survey X-rays, but also X-rays when it comes to reading them at yearling sales and how the repository works. So James Price will be taking Jonathan through there. And also something that might be a little bit foreign to people who are new to this industry, and that's pinhooking foals. We've got Mark Devsich, who's a very good judge of weanlings. He's turned investments of 40 and 50,000 last year into 150, 200,000 this year on several occasions. So we're just going to talk to Mark a little bit about what he looks for when he's selecting weanlings to pinhook into yearling sales. So look, hopefully you get a bit out of it. I know there's some old hands in the room, so a fair bit of what we're going to talk about is probably passé for a lot of people who have been involved in the industry. But as I said, there's a lot of new faces, so I hope you do enjoy the evening. At the end, we will get all the panellists up, and so if you'd like to keep your questions to the end, we'll have 10 or 15 minutes, and please feel free to ask anything of any of our guest speakers tonight.
Thank you. You've done very well remembering every single person speaking without even looking at the notes. I'm very impressed. But first of all, Jonathan, as you mentioned, broodmare selection, it is just so important, isn't it? And, you know, as you said, some people are buying these broodmares and they want to breed a foal to race themselves. But it's so important, if you are breeding to sell commercially, that you really know what you're getting in for. So what are some of the tips you'd give as far as selecting broodmares if you want to actually breed them to sell?
Look, Caroline, it's something we could probably talk all night about, but to condense it into a couple of minutes, I suppose the first thing you want to do is make sure that the mare that you're buying, that someone's going to want to buy the progeny out of her. So just put yourself in a trainer or a syndicator's position at a yearling sale. Is the mare that you're buying today going to produce you a yearling that they are going to be interested in? So first and foremost, has she got racetrack performance? Now, that's not to say that an unraced mare can't be a very commercial brood mare, but if we start at that racetrack performance, it is a help if she's a winning mare. Obviously, it's a bigger help if she's one black type on the racetrack. And of course, that is going to be influenced in the sale ring by the price that she brings. So everyone here is going to be working on a budget from Darley, if they're buying their mares, or Coolmore buying their mares, all the way down to someone who's buying their first mare and maybe looking at a spend of $5,000 or $10,000. But you've got to try and remember that if you're breeding commercially, you've got to start by having a mare that's going to be favourable in the sale ring when you're selling out of her. So the things I'd suggest for certainly broodmare sire, like yearling size or the size of progeny in the ring, buyers take a set against stallions that haven't been successful. So with a broodmare sire, you can access a lot of information on the internet now. Bloodstock.com's got all the information on what a mare's produce have made in the past, what yearlings are averaging by all the sires. So you can go to that website and find a lot of information prior to the sale. But also, when you're looking at the mares that are in this catalogue or in any catalogue, have a look at what's the mare by? Is that stallion a successful broodmare sire, or was he at least successful with his progeny on the racetrack? If he wasn't a success, that's a negative to the broodmare. It's not a death knell, but it is a negative. Therefore, if you tick that box, you then go to, as I said, was she a winner on the racetrack? Did she earn black type? If she wasn't, make sure she's from a winning family. So hopefully she's a half relation to black type, or at the very least a half relation to horses that have won in the metropolitan area. So those horses are designated by naming the races, and I'm sure most of you in the room would understand where the metropolitan tracks of Australia are. And onwards from there, winning families that are active, with lots of fillies in those first two generations, that means they're on the chance to improve.
I know obviously there are a lot of very astute buyers in the room, but for the people that aren't sort of so aware of how buyers select the mares they're looking at, you don't necessarily need to look at every single mare on the ground. So we're looking at these big sales these days with hundreds and hundreds of mares. It's not quite the same as looking at yearlings in particular and how they walk. What would you advise people to be looking for to really cull that list so you're not looking at everything, but what are some of the specifics people should look for if they want to just condense that shortlist?
Look, certainly, Carolyn, I think one of the first things you do is, okay, you've got to know your budget. If you're coming in and you've got a budget of $20,000 to buy a mare, the first thing you look for is, the majority of mares here or at any sale are going to be in foal, and you can very quickly research on Stallion Parade or any of those websites. You can find out what those stallions stand for. Now, there will be mares sold on Sunday that will make under the service fee that the mare's been covered with, but if the mare's been covered by a stallion standing at $50,000 or above, you're not going to be buying it for $20,000. So that's the first thing. So you can cut out those mares that are going to fold to Redoute's Choice and Fastnet Rock, unfortunately. But then you start to say, okay, well, what stallions do I want to be buying mares in fold to? Obviously, in recent years, and Peter's going to talk a little bit more about this shortly, first season stallions have been very popular in the yearling sale ring. But we at Inglis, as Chris and Simon will talk about later, proven stallions are always a pretty safe bet. If a stallion's got runners on the racetrack and he's successful, it's a big head start to getting your yearling into a sale ring. So I think the stallion that the mare's in foal to is very important, first and foremost. Look, secondly, I think, as I said, you've got to buy into a family that's active and has got some black type or performance-based around it. So if you're looking at mares that have had 6-7 foals that haven't had success on the racetrack, you pretty much cull those out as well, because when we get round to selecting our yearling catalogues, they're the sort of yearlings. If it's the 8th foal of a mare and she hasn't had success on the racetrack, unfortunately, we're going to put it to the side unless they're an absolutely outstanding type.
A lot of people, very successful buyers of broodmares have a real set against older mares, but often you can find an older mare, particularly if she's done the job already, who can still produce the goods. What are the, as the question says up there, the do's and don'ts about buying older mares that have been at stud more than 5 years?
Look, you're right. I mean, one of the things, and you'll see this at every broodmare sale, you'll see it next week, But, you know, those young stakes-winning mares off the track, or the good city winners with the half relations, or daughters of black type winners, they make a lot of money. They make 50, 100, 200,000. So a lot of us haven't got that budget to play with. So sometimes you do have to discount on what you can afford. So one of the things is, as Caroline suggests, buying a mare that has had a few foals, and if you're buying a mare, perhaps a good race mare that's had a few foals, you can take a chance, as Emirates Park did a few years ago, and buy a mare like Watchful, who she'd had four or five foals, had been to good stallions, and they bought her for $55,000. The next one of the earlier foals turned out to be Sepoy, a Golden Slipper winner. So that can happen, and it happens quite often. I know Stratum's mother went through a broodmare sale and made about $70,000, and the foal she was carrying turned out to be, of course, turned out to be Stratum, and then, of course, the breeder who had bought her for $70,000 or $80,000 had that mare all the way through her career. So those older mares, you're discounting on her age, and you are taking a chance that in those three, four, five foal that she's had, that one of them is going to produce on the racetrack. What I would say is you can do the research and find out, first and foremost, what the foals have made when they've been sold. As I said, that information is readily available on bloodstock.com through their sales results database. And so that gives you the information that you can go and find out who's training them. And if they're in the Chris Waller camp or the David Hayes camp or the Mick Price camp, you're thinking, well, I'm a live chance here. You know, Mick Price is training the three-year-old out of the mare. You know, the mare's in foal to a stallion that I give some chance to. And suddenly, a lot of professional breeders do start to sell their mares when they get to 12 and 14 years of age. It's an opportunity for breeders getting involved in the industry to buy those types of mares and hopefully come up with a gold mine.
You touched on the good race mares as brood mares, and often they don't necessarily have, you know, instantly the first three, four, five foals as really good winners, but often it's their grand foals that are sensational. So if you're buying a mare that's over 15, obviously there are some other criteria to think about there, but at the same time the family can rapidly improve even though she might not have necessarily done the job herself.
Oh, absolutely. That gets back to that research that I've suggested. I mean, it does take time. I mean, the catalogue comes out 3 to 4 weeks prior to a sale, but when you do open up that catalogue, you can really, you know, you can put yourself to sleep with it most nights, because once you get involved in those pedigrees, you do start to think, well, hang on, what if that happens, or I really like that cross, or things like that. We're not going to get too deep into pedigrees tonight, but I think the opportunities are, if you set yourself a budget, do the homework on as many mares as you can in the catalogue, and then be ready and wait to see what they're bringing through the ring. I would always suggest that you go and look at them. It's very important, and we'll talk, you know, throughout the evening on the importance of type and things like that. But, you know, if you can buy a nice vehicle, we call a mare that is going to carry a foal well, and once again, you'll find by researching that the results that the mare has produced in the sale already, if she's selling yearlings that are selling well, selling commercially through the good sales, that means she's throwing good types, and that's half the battle.
From an English point of view, or if you're buying again commercially with these brood mares, as you talked about, pedigree obviously is very important. But what about type? I mean, if you're talking about a mare that has to carry a foal and grow a nice sort of a good sized foal, how important is type versus pedigree?
Oh, look, Caroline, if you're asking me the question 20 years ago, I would have said, you know, type was probably 20 to 30% and pedigree is probably 70%. I think you can almost reverse that now. I think certainly, you know, the experts in the room will back me up. It's become very type focused. The trainers, the syndicators, you know, the agents, they all want to buy the physical specimen, the horse that looks like it's going to run through a brick wall for you, the horses that are popular and big and strong. Whereas in bygone days, you know, pedigree was everything. You know, I bought the one out of the Golden Slipper, I bought the half relation of the Derby winner. That was what everyone wanted to take home from the yearling sale. So when you start with your broodmare, you really want to start with a mare that's going to throw you a physical specimen that's going to be popular in the sale ring. So size-wise, you're really wanting to buy a mare that is, you know, 15.3 and above, preferably 16 hands or 16.1, and that gives you the access to go to perhaps smaller stallions that are successful. If you're buying a mare that's 15.2 or smaller, it does rule out a few of these smaller stallions that you know, need a bit of leg to throw a decent sort of foal. If you're buying a mare that's got plenty of bone and substance, once again, you can go to some of the sire lines that perhaps don't produce those big, robust sort of horses. It's breeding away from faults. Obviously, if you buy, I mean, if you have to discount on something, if you discount on a mare's front legs because she's offset and pigeon-toed, but you like everything else about her, you like her sire, you like the family, she's big, strong, okay, that's fine, but you want to go then to a stallion that's correct, trying to breed away from the faults that she's got.
Mm. And as far as valuing a mare being offered for sale, obviously, you know, we hear so much about the vendors having to be realistic about the prices the horses are going to make. How do you value from a vendor's point of view and from your point of view to maybe say, hang on, you might need to reassess it? How do you value that mare being sold?
Look, Caroline, it's difficult. I think the one thing that we as auctioneers, as a sales company, have is experience. I mean, and that's a lot of the people in, or you know, some of the stud masters in the room would have the same sort of experience. And that comes from following sales and watching what, you know, similar mares are making last year and this year and following the market. Obviously, we're in a fashion industry, incredibly so. I mean, what's popular 6 months ago, 12 months ago, could be out of fashion now. And that's the one thing to remember. It's difficult when you're breeding 18 months ago to produce something for a yearling sale or a weanling sale. But when you're about to buy a broodmare, you want to be as up-to-date as possible on the fashion. So once again, you can go back and look at what's been popular at the sales this year. You can find out all the sire averages. If you're looking at first season stallions, go and look not only at, you know, if mares have got weanlings on the ground, if you're looking at the weanlings, you can see, gee, I've really, you know, been impressed with those Pieros or those Your Songs or those Accelerations. I'm going to take a punt. Looking at the foals, I'm going to take a punt and go and buy a mare in foal to the horse second season, because that's where you really can get a great result. You know, some breeders will be a little bit hesitant to buy a mare in foal to a second season stallion. But if you do your homework and you're confident that, you know, the mare is, or that the stallion is throwing nice types that have been popular in the sale ring, if they're yearlings or they've been popular as weanings and they look the part, that's where you can get a jump on the rest of the breeding scene.
All right, thank you, Darce. And you will be back later if you have any questions about any of that at the end of the seminar. Jonathan will be back up here, so please thank Jonathan Darcy for now until we get you back. And now it's time to have a chat with Peter Hegney, of course, based in Victoria. Good old South Australian boy. And I must say, I know you are winding down, of course, your role with Inglis, but I'm sure everyone here in the room would want to congratulate you on a fantastic time you've been in this industry full stop, and particularly with Inglis based in Victoria.
Congratulations. Thanks, Kara. I'm not going anywhere for a while.
No, I know it's a while, but still, it's interesting. They're interesting times, aren't they?
Yeah, very much so.
Yeah. Now, looking at the stallions, now we've talked about the difference between, as far as the brood mares, you're buying a horse or trying to send a mare to a horse as far as being commercial as opposed to just breeding it to race. How important is that stallion?
Vitally important, I think, and I, as Jonathan did, and as you just alluded to then, I'd like to preface what I've got to say in the sense that I am speaking totally commercially. If you want to breed a horse to your own nicks, crosses, everything else that go with it, that's fine. I certainly wouldn't be presumptuous enough to interfere with that whatsoever. However, commercially speaking, and obviously we're in the commercial business, that's why we're discussing it tonight. It's an interesting question, isn't it? How important is the stallion selection? I think it's probably divided amongst a lot of people. In fact, if I may, just before I just start talking, could I ask who thinks the broodmare is the most important part of the mating? Just a show of hands. Yeah, and those who think the stallion's the most important part of it? Probably fairly divided, I'd suggest, for our online viewers, I would think. I would have to say, from a commercial point of view, we see the stallion as being vitally important. In fact, we have a statement in our business that stallions sell yearlings. I'm going to contradict that in a moment, but initially, as you would see, the yearlings at the major sales that top the sale are usually by commercial stallions. And so I think it's vitally important that you have a stallion that is going to be commercial in the yearling sale ring. I will contradict that right now by saying it's quite often the case that, well, I won't in fact contradict it, but what I will say is that it's often interesting how, and I think it probably actually reinforces what I said, that a half relation to a successful racehorse by a commercial stallion will often make a lot more in the sale ring than a full relation. And I know that sounds a little bit crazy in some respects. The full relation's worked, it's proven. But it may not be a highly commercial stallion. And therefore, if the yearling in the sale ring might be, again, by picking on Redoutes or Fastnet or whatever, then it's highly likely that yearling is going to make more than the actual full relation. It's a big decision to make, choosing stallions. You make it 2.5 years, of course, before you get to sell the progeny. That's a long time. As Jonathan mentioned, this is a fashion-conscious industry. It's really, really hard to predict. You can't predict what's going to be fashionable in clothing in 2.5 years. How can we predict what's going to be fashionable or successful in 2.5 years from when we make our decision to send our mare to a stallion? But I think it's something that we need to give very, very serious thought to. And again, I'll reiterate, we believe stallions sell yearlings.
Very much so, and on the pedigree side particularly. But as far as the confirmation side, there's no point sending a great big massive sort of a mare to a Redoute's Choice or a Fastnet Rock. Obviously, confirmation plays a big, big part.
Yes, it certainly does. Jonathan again spoke about the confirmation of the broodmare, which I think is important. And of course, there are always very, you know, great exceptions to the rule. But as far as the stallion is concerned, most of the stallions that go to stud are well conformed. Most of them have been good race sources. They therefore have conformational attributes as well as race record attributes, and quite often they go hand in hand. Again, a matter of choosing the right stallion, despite the fact that pedigrees might nick well or mash well, if they're not compatible on type, then it's usually not an ideal way to go. So I think before anybody makes a decision, as Jonathan again said, I think you certainly should go and see the stallion before you send your mare off, because at the end of the day, that might have a big bearing on the resultant progeny.
And looking, of course, at the service fee, you know, a lot of theories around about the value of the mare compared to the stallion service fee. How do you see that? I mean, obviously, you're not going to send a really valuable mare to a really inexpensive stallion if you want to be commercial at sale. But there is obviously some sort of a measure of what her value is as opposed to the service fee.
Yes, we normally advocate that breeders with mares breed up. In other words, go to a stallion that perhaps is just slightly better than your mare. Doesn't mean to say, as you say, with a really modestly bred mare that you go overboard and send it to one of the top sires at the most expensive service fees. But principally, you're trying to breed up. Now, there is a slight, in my opinion, exception to that. If you have a reasonably good mare, and let's say you've got a nice, modest, listed stakes-winning mare with a reasonable pedigree, and you'd probably love and can afford to send her to the best sire in the land. But then you think about it, you realise that you're probably going to be at the very low end of the pecking order when it comes to the yearling sales. So sometimes in that situation, you actually might be better to go to a lesser stallion, at which time you're going to be one of the best, perhaps the best, by that stallion in the sale ring. So I think it's something you should consider. Don't just automatically go overboard and send your mare to the best stallion that's available unless she genuinely warrants it. And unless you are going to be up in at least the top 50 or 60% when it comes to yearling sale. If not, maybe you can mate down a little bit. Still going to a commercial stallion, obviously, but something that will put you, again, in the top bracket of yearlings by that particular stallion.
There is always risk, I guess, involved when you're choosing that stallion. How can you reduce that risk? There are obviously some things you've thought of.
Yes, well, I suppose you've got to try and reduce the risk, basically. That's what it's all about, isn't it? And a lot of that has got to do with, how you mate your mare and the quality of stallion that you go to. The other aspect I think that's quite important is to go to a stallion that you know is going to be well marketed out there in the marketplace. Now, I'm sure many of you here are aware that some studs and some operations are much better at marketing their stallion and the progeny when it comes to the sale ring, particularly first season sires. Now, we'll get to talking about first season sires, I'm sure, in a moment, but I think that does have a bearing. You may love a stallion and really, really like him, but you think, oh, he's only going to have 30 foals in his first year. He stands at a nice little operation out in the back block somewhere, and he's not really going to get the promotion and marketing in the sale ring. So I think that is certainly something that you should take into consideration if, again, you are breeding for the sale ring. Breeding for your own purpose, totally different thing. But I think that's one of the aspects that you should really consider.
There is amazing hype, of course, around those first season sires. We've just seen, you know, the Sepoys, Smart Missiles, Fox Wedges, So You Thinks. At the yearling sales, we have the All Too Hards, Pieros, etc. At the weanling sales coming up. But what are your thoughts on the first season sire? Because obviously you can have big numbers, they're unproven, but they're very sexy.
They are. We've just seen an exceptional year, I guess, because we've had so many well-credentialed first-season sires, and they've had an amazing impact in the sale ring, and I won't repeat what you have already have observed. But interestingly, you know, it's not actually a new phenomenon. It's been around for a while. I can remember back in the 60s when Lindsay Park presented the first of the Attilas, and they topped the Adelaide sale ring. They followed that up in the 70s without fear. They sold through the roof as well. And then Widden stood True Version. His progeny topped the Melbourne Yelling Sire, despite the fact he was standing in New South Wales that year. And he was a first-season sire. Back in 2006, the first of the Rocket Gibraltars sold 33 of them sold for just under $300,000 in their first year. And then, of course, since then, we've seen the likes of Stratums, whose yearlings have sold so very well, averaged over nearly 350 in his first year, and even God's Own, who averaged something like $220,000 in his first year. So it's not actually new. It's just that I think this year we've had such a run and such a depth of our first season sires. Personally, I'm a great fan of sending mares to first season sires, keeping in mind what I said earlier about on the understanding that firstly, that's those stallions suit your mare, and secondly, they're coming off studs that are going to market and present well, that will have a decent sized draft in the yearling sale. I'm not saying you necessarily need 80 yearlings by a particular stallion. In fact, it can be saturated with too many. But I think you need to know that at least the stallions have served a sound book of mares, so there will be enough yearlings available to launch in the sale ring, which will in itself create a bit of hype. Personally, I think if you go to a well-credentialed stallion at one of those commercial operations, I think it's quite a sound move. It's always a gamble, of course, going to second, third and fourth year stallions, and some of which will be very successful. But it's a pretty sound investment, in my opinion, to go to a first season sire if it meets the other criteria that suit you.
It is interesting, though, we see some sires really become commercial, whether it be through racetrack performance or sales results or what they've actually, you know, had as offspring themselves. But why are some of them more commercial? Some of them seem to have better credentials, whether it be racetrack performance. But again, it probably gets back to marketing a lot of it, doesn't it, with the farms?
I'm sure it does. You're quite right. Look, I'm sure if you look at the leading sires in the land across the board, it's unquestionable that the majority of them are Group 1 winners. Now, that's of course not to say that there are some outstanding lesser-performed stallions, but generally speaking, the top stallions have been outstanding performers in their own right. Yes, we've had, I'm sure people throw up to me, horses like Noble Bijou and Melee and so forth, you know, many years ago that had virtually no race record or unraced. But across the board, and I'm speaking generally, those good race horses generally make the better stallions. And I don't want anybody to jump down my throat who's got a Group 3 or Group 2 winning stallion, because they too have every opportunity. And I'm sure you, like I, can cite some of those horses who are currently in the top 30 stallions in the land. But by far the majority of them are certainly Group 1 performers.
Nicks and crosses, obviously, there are a lot of people that are absolute pedigree aficionados and they're diehards about, you know, nicking this stallion and, you know, the dam sire is X, Y, Z. How important are those nicks and crosses? Of course, a good broodmare sire is vitally important too, isn't it?
Yes, it is. How important are those nicks and crosses? If you're breeding for your own purpose, they're probably very important to you. And I would certainly not challenge that if you're breeding for your own purpose. If you are breeding commercially, quite frankly, I'd say be a little careful about that. The buying public out there don't necessarily... There are so many of these theories out there, and I certainly wouldn't say which ones are right and which ones are wrong. But what I will say is the buying public out there are not necessarily aware of the way you've mated your yearling. And even if they are, they may say, so what? Particularly if it's the trainers. Now, with respect, I think trainers are not so concerned about the breeding theories that you have bred your yearling upon. Yes, of course, at the end of the day, you want to breed a good racehorse. But initially, you want to breed a horse that's going to sell and sell well in the sale ring. So I do ask, don't inflict your breeding theories on the buying public out there. You may get the right result with a progeny if it races successfully, and congratulations if that's the case. But again, repeating myself, it may not have the same impact on the buyers. The majority of buyers, like an individual, they like what they see on the pedigree page. They don't necessarily agree with a host of breeding theories out there. Look, I'm probably the wrong one to ask. I'm not a great breeding theorist, quite frankly, but again, I'm certainly speaking commercially and again, wouldn't challenge anybody who does want to back their own breeding theories. And if you're breeding to race it yourself, go for your life. I hope you're very, very successful.
How important, we obviously are seeing, we see this question about, you know, obviously buying imported horses versus buying staying type horses here in Australia and actually taking them all the way through, which has got to be less expensive than buying the rotten things overseas. But as far as those sires, we really are pushing, aren't we, to have some of the Americanes and you know, Fiorentina, you've got the Darley and Coolmore, they've been trying to bring some of those European bred staying stallions here for a long time. You've got So You Think, you know, Dundeal in the Hunter Valley. So how important is it to encourage people to look at those sorts of horses to actually really invest with, and how commercial can they be?
Good question, and you're perfectly right. Look, there is no question that currently in Australia, propensity is for speed. A two-year-old racing is so strong here, but interestingly, the majority of the big prize money, of course, with the exception of the Golden Slipper, is for staying in classic type races. Yet despite that, we've still got this obsession about breeding speed horses and early coming two-year-olds. And that's not going to change dramatically. However, I do applaud the fact that we are now starting to introduce a little bit more stamina into some of our pedigrees and some of our stallions, because that's what we want to produce here in Australia to win our Cup and classic races. As you say, we're getting a little sick of all the imports coming and raping our great prize money here, and that's competition and that's fine, but it would be really nice if we could. Now, I'm not going to say they're going to be massively impacting or influential in the sale ring initially. I think it might be a little bit crawl before you walk situation. No doubt there are some horses out there, and they're great, beautifully credentialed horses with great pedigrees and wonderful race records. Obviously, it's highly successful in Europe. It had previously been successful in New Zealand until, in my opinion, they went away from what they were best at, and that it was breeding stayers, and tried to influence speed into their pedigrees, and quite frankly, I'm not sure it worked. But they were very good at it. So it works everywhere else. We can breed good sprinters here and good two-year-olds. Why can't we breed good stayers? I see no reason whatsoever. But don't go overboard, and particularly breeding horses that are going to be extremely stout, because it will be a gradual process. If we are successful with the stallions we're standing at the moment, the horses that have won cups and classics, yes, people will be much more receptive to it. But the general consensus out there with the buyers is that we've got a whole new wave of buyers out there, and maybe I'm speaking away from my topic. We've got a whole new wave of buyers out there at the moment who don't necessarily understand the time it takes for a staying type horse to develop. Many years ago, when it was back, the sales were supported so strongly by rural people who had a horse background, they understood, they could be tolerant, they would wait. Whereas these days we've got a wave of new people coming in, highly successful city businessmen who want some action pretty quickly. Of course, when it comes to Melbourne Cup Carnival or the Sydney Carnival here, everybody wants a Derby winner, or they want to win the Sydney Cup or the Melbourne Cup. But you tell them their progeny is not going to perform until it's at least at 3.5, then they'll back off just a touch. But I'm delighted to see the support that is being given, and I really, really hope that it is successful.
All right, very enlightening.
One other thing I'll just say very quickly then, if I may. It's interesting about the commercial perception of some stallions. Now, again, you can look through the top stallions in the land, and I had a quick look the other day, and of the top 20 stallions, 10 of those in the yearling sale ring last year, their median price was under $100,000. Now, $100 certainly not to be sneezed at, but what I am saying is there's a commercial perception out there of some stallions as opposed to others. Unfortunately, results on the racetrack don't always relate to the sale ring. So I think you should be mindful of that. And I know we are, as a company, we say such and such has been a very, very good stallion, but look at his progeny. They've averaged 45,000 in the sale. He's 15th leading sire in Australia. He should be averaging 145,000. But there's a perception out there that he's a bit ho-hum. He might be a little bit stale for whatever reason. And unfortunately, it's not for us to judge what the buyers out there interpret or what they want. We have to supply what the buyers want. There's no good in producing red Holdens, everybody wants to buy white Holdens. They're the same car. They all run all those sorts of things. But that's an aspect I think you should be mindful of. Just have a look what the progeny is. I know Jonathan spoke about earlier about the sale prices of broodmares and so forth. Just be mindful of what is commercial and what is successful in the sale ring. And again, 2.5 years down the track, pretty hard to do, I know that.
Very much so. Please thank Peter Hegney. Thank you, Peter. I call up Sam Fairgray, of course, now with Inglis, formerly with Arrowfield for many, many years. Welcome, Sam.
Thanks, Caroline. Good evening, everyone.
Going to be really interesting to hear some of your thoughts on particularly the weanling side of things and what you need to do raising a weanling. Do you buy, do you sell? But starting off, I guess the issue is when you're looking at a foal at an early age, how on earth do you decide whether you want to keep the foal, raise it to either yearling or race it or whatever, or sell it as a weanling? How do you decide?
Absolutely. It starts off, obviously, you've got to have the business plan. Jonathan and Peter have spoken about with the mare and the stallion. And then, obviously, once the mare foals, you've got to make the assessment on the foal at an early age. Where you think that foal's going to end up, whether you think you're going to take it through to a yearling stage or you're going to sell it as a weanling, and looking at the cost structure of what it's going to cost you to take it through to yearling stage versus taking it through to a weanling sale and your return. And that's what you need to assess in those early days when the foal's born, and then heading through to when you're going to wean it. So you've got to plan and stage. And that's the important thing, I think, with breeding. You've got to always have a business plan, and you've always got to be planning and thinking ahead what your plan is.
Obviously, a lot of people hear from farms that are actually really hands-on, and they know what the weaning process involves. But for people that might have, you know, a new farm or their own mares and their own foals, just explain the weaning process. When should the foal be weaned?
Caroline, the weaning process is vital. It's the first time in a foal's life that it's had that human contact where you're actually educating it how to lead, how to pick up its feet, and you're going to be taking it away from its mother who's been supplying it with milk every day. And foals can drink up to 18 kilos of milk per day. So you're going to be taking it away from its mother. So you've got to, firstly, you've got to think about the feeding of it. And that's got to start before you actually wean it. So you've got to, once again, you're planning as you're going into that weaning phase. But the handling of the foal is vital. It's a very stressful time for the foals. So you need to be very patient with them, understand the horse. And sometimes some foals take to it very quickly, other foals are a bit more timid, and you've got to take a bit more time. But getting through that weaning process is really important, and there are certain things you can do to help that. And it's a stressful time, so you might want to put your foal on anti-ulcer treatment and things like that, which is just going to help it through that stressful time. Also, you're thinking it's going from having all that milk to going on to just grain. So that changeover also is important for the foal's gut to be able to handle that and have a smooth transition through that stage.
How much feed do they actually need? I mean, obviously you're supplementing mum's milk, they've been grazing a little bit and they've been having a bit of mum's feed as well, but how much does a weanling actually need to eat at that point?
It varies very much, and I advise everyone to contact a nutritionist and find out exactly you know, what your property needs are as far as supplements and so forth. But most foals will need probably, they'll eat up to 3.5 kilos of dry matter, which is fibre, which is really important for the development of foal, and also, you know, the grains, obviously. So, but it's an individual case, and each farm will be different because you'll have different pastures and so forth, and the ability of the foal to uptake all the minerals and so forth at that stage.
How important is it to be consistent, or what is the consistency of feeding weanlings? Obviously some paddocks, you know, at certain times of the year can be particularly dry depending on where you live around Australia. How consistent do you have to be, or how often a day do they need a feed?
Consistency is vital, I believe, in the rearing of a weanling. If you can keep your weanling on that equal nutritional plane, that is the key to ending up with a good physical specimen that will hopefully not have any long-term issues. So being able to develop that diet that you can take it all the way through from that weaning process all the way through to the yearling sale is vital. And once again, it's all about planning. And you've got to know your climate in your area and the changes and so forth, because the colder climates, you need to adjust when your horse is going into that, but not sudden increments. It's just got to be general and balanced so that all the way through that foal's able to absorb all those minerals. You're not overloading it with energy. You're not overloading it with products that the horse can't take, and its bones grow too quickly, and then you get problems.
Obviously, we see at certain times of the year on irrigated farms this lovely lush grass, but there's a big difference, isn't there, between them eating grass all day and actually really needing a serious feed with the right components to it.
Absolutely. You get such different variances with the grasses and so forth, and it's lovely seeing a foal out in a lovely lush green paddock, but not necessarily is it going to be getting all the nutrients and so forth that it needs. So quite often the pastures will have a high water content, so the foal won't be getting as much fibre as it needs there. So you need to supplement that by giving it, you know, extra lucerne and extra hay and so forth. So although your pastures may look great and so forth, you need to actually maybe have them tested, your soil and your pastures tested to see exactly what's in them. And once again, they change from season to season. Going into spring, your pastures are generally going to be very lush and so forth. But in the winter and in the heights of summer, it's going to be very different. So you need to adjust the feeding with your seasons.
And of course, the weanling, depending on, I guess, size of mare and the stallion and so forth, how do you tell when they're at the right stage? What is the right stage, the right height, the right weight? How do you tell all that?
There's some good programs you can get onto as far as tracking your foals' progress, and that is really important to be able to track the foal as it grows and develops. And observation is the key. If you can constantly monitor your foal and you're checking its legs and you're checking its growth and development, and it's the key to keeping your foal in the right line so it gets to the yearling sale and the right growth pattern that you want. And there's plenty of people that are out to assist. There's obviously all the bloodstock team here and in Melbourne. If you want a little advice on if you think your foal's going and the weanling's going in the right direction, give one of us a call and we'll be happy to come out, because we see hundreds of foals all the time and we can give you an idea of where your foal's sitting.
So what have you done as far as a weanling? Obviously, as you said, it's some of the first handling that these horses really get. What do you do with the weanlings with, you know, obviously having in mind that they might then need to be coming to a sale as a yearling? What do you do with your preparation with them as foals once they're off their mum?
It is an education process, and when you get to that point of bringing them into the yearling prep, that's into that final stage where you need everything to run smoothly and perfectly, and you want the horse to be comfortable in its surroundings. So all the things that it's going to be involved within that prep, you might like to do that through the winter. In the colder months, you might like to bring it into a box and put a rug on it and teach it to go onto the horse walker and do all the little things that's going to happen to it during the prep, but in a smaller stage. You might only do it for 3 or 4 days and then put it back out, but then the horse learns to come in. It knows what it's like to be in a box, have a rug on, go on a horse walker, and they learn to become an individual at that stage as well. And it's really important, so when they come in for the yearling prep, straight away that horse is relaxed and settled, it's eating, it's happy in its environment.
Are there any other things you can do as far as trying to really get the best out of that weanling, looking at it going towards the yearling sales?
It's like presenting it in the best fashion you can. And there's a few little things that one of my biggest gripes and pet hates is a chewed tail, because it's like, who's going to go and buy a brand new car with a dent in it? Okay, if there's one there, it just takes away from the whole perception of the horse. You want to take that horse there without any cuts on it, without any blemishes and so forth. And chewed tails, horses do it when it rains because of the salt that runs through the tail, so they'll start to chew. Also, if they're lacking something. So if you see that start to happen, but there's cribox is easy. You put a bit of cribox in the tail a couple of times and then it builds up a bit of residue there, and away you go. And you'll find that once they get that taste for cribox, they won't want to chew anymore. The other thing that's a little helpful hint is always if you're injecting a horse IV in the vein, always go on the off side, which is the right hand side of the horse, because there's a ligament that runs all the way up that side of the neck that if you actually hit that, you can actually cause paralysis in the horse's epiglottis. So that's just a little tip for yearlings.
Very interesting. Please thank Sam Fairgrey. Thank you, Sam. Really appreciate that. No, lots of handy little hints in there and some great information too. Now, I'm going to step aside now because Jonathan Darcy is going to be coming back here and he's going to be chatting with Mark Devsich from Henley Park over there in New Zealand. They're going to be talking about pinhooking weanlings. Excuse me. Welcome back, Darcy.
Thanks, Carolyn. Go and have a little cup of soup there, just being handed around, everyone. So if you're feeling a bit peckish, Jenny and her team are just handing around a little bit of soup, so make yourselves comfortable. Welcome, Mark. For those of you who haven't met Mark and his lovely wife Sarah, they run Henley Park over in New Zealand. We thought we'd get Mark along tonight to talk a little bit about pinhooking, which is where you buy a weanling, as we're selling here on Sunday, and take it through to a yearling sale next year. So welcome, Mark. And why was it you chose to get involved with this pinhooking side of the industry?
For us, it was probably very much a natural progression. We we'd been working on stud farms for a number of years, and we were exposed to that pinhooking. Obviously, there was farms that were doing that at that present time, and we realised there was favourable returns in pinhooking. So when the opportunity arose to start pinhooking, that was after we started managing a stud farm. We decided that was a good time to start pinhooking. So from there, we purchased our first horse at Melbourne. I think I paid $18,000 for him, and he ended up making $80,000. So from there, it sort of snowballed from there, and we sort of started getting some bit of luck on the pinhooking side. So no, it was great, and we've enjoyed it ever since. We've sort of kept increasing our numbers, and hopefully we'll keep doing that and making returns.
Well, absolutely. So it's great to have Mark here. And what we're going to do over the next 5 or 10 minutes is just learn a little bit more about the art of pin hooking. I know there are a couple of people in the room that are interested in this. So, I mean, the next month or 6 weeks is going to be a very busy period for you and Sarah. When the catalogues first come out, what's the first thing you do when you start to read through the pedigrees?
First and foremost are the stallions. As Peter Higney alluded to, stallions drive your market. And that's what dictates what trainers and buyers really want. So we go through and select the stallions that are well performed, commercial, and well performed obviously on the racetrack, and from there we obviously select them from that criteria. And obviously your first season size, they have to be well performed, well marketed. Obviously they go to farms that know how to market horses extremely well, and that sort of helps you when you go to selling a yearling.
Yeah, you had a great result with a Master of Design colt you bought here for, I think, around $52,000 and turned into $210,000 at the Melbourne Premier Sale this year. Is first season size, you know, a really positive way to go, or do you like proven size as well? I mean, is there a balance there?
I think there's a balance. First season size, obviously, what attracted us to the Master Design colt, he was a very good type, and 9 times out of 10, when you're selling yearlings, type sells. That really sells. It makes it a lot easier for you when you're actually trying to market the horse. But there was a couple other factors that were involved. Obviously, he was a son of Reduce Choice, who's been a sire of sires. He was well performed on the racetrack. He was from a great family, and he was standing at a stud that marketed well too. So there was all those things that sort of fitted the puzzle, you know. And that's what made us made it easier for us to purchase the horse. Yeah,
absolutely. So I suppose you've picked out horses that you're interested in on Sunday and the other weaning sales coming up. You get to the sales ground. I mean, what's the process you take forward from there? I mean, yourself and Sarah are here today. You've been doing some inspections. Well, what are you looking for when you're getting out these horses out of their barn?
Well, obviously you're looking for a type. You want an athlete. You want something that's got good muscle, is correct, good head, and plenty of presence. I also look for a horse that's got a good hip. Obviously, that's where all the power comes from. So those are some of the factors that we sort of take.
Okay. And I mean, we look at, you know, the horses here. You've got horses that are born in August, September, all the way through to November. A foaling date and size important factors at this time?
A little bit, yes. I tend to avoid, obviously, small horses a little bit, but obviously we know some stallions that are in high demand, a lot of people will overlook that. So those are sort of, yeah, that's what I sort of tend to sort of look for.
Mm. I mean, a lot of people, when you get to weaning sales and yearling sales, you talk about movement, about the way the horse carries itself. I mean, is that something you can detect in these weanings at this age?
Oh, definitely. If a horse really moves and walks boldly, it sort of it catches your eye, and if it has a little bit of a good little overstep, it makes it easy to sell them when it comes to yearlings, definitely.
Yeah. Mark, with I mean, obviously some of these horses are being sold because they have issues, others are being sold because breeders think it's a time to be selling them because they're nice and strong and athletic. Are there certain faults that you see in weanlings that you think, okay, I can take that home and with corrective shoeing or with different methods, I can get that horse right for a yearling sale?
There is. I've had a little bit of success over horses that have turned out. I feel they're easier to bring around than horses that actually are pigeon-toed, because what happens with horses that are pigeon-toed, they tend to get heavy in front and then they start to toe in a lot more. So, hey, listen, there's always exceptions. You always can, and diet does control weight, so you've got to obviously take that into consideration.
I suppose one of the most important things, I mean, certainly from where I sit, the you know, your profit's pretty much made the day you buy your weaning, I always say. I mean, when you're sitting down and setting prices, are you fairly rigid when you go into the sale ring after that?
Oh, just, hey, you'd always, when you go to the sale ring, you always hope to make a profit, don't you? That's that's always the number one. But hey, listen, when you go in the ring, you just got to, I just basically run its course. And, you know, if there's a horse that I like, I try and buy it within reason. Yeah, obviously don't go too silly. But, yeah, that's basically how I sort of protect the price.
Have you got a strategy out there? Do you hide and watch anyone else bidding, or do you just stand under the tree and go your hardest?
No, I just put the blinkers on.
What about insurance? Is that something that you and Sarah think is important when you're buying a weaning, taking it through to a yearling stage?
Hey, I think importance. Insurance is very important. Obviously, you know, horses. There's always fatalities with horses, and you're trying to protect your investment. So I think it's a very, very important processes.
Sure. Mark, I mean, some people might be buying weanings. I certainly hope you and Sarah will be buying weanings on Sunday. What's the process, you know, through, I mean, without going into chapter and verse about the next 6 months, but what's the process for the first couple of weeks after you get them home to Cambridge?
Well, what we do is we probably put them in, we mate them up with another horse, and we put them, and obviously they go out into a paddock, and they stay in that paddock probably for about a week to 10 days, so they get used to each other, and they end up being good mates. And then after that, we put them out into a bigger field. It might be with another two or three horses. So when it goes out there, it's already mated up with something. So it's not by itself. It's not getting picked on. So it ends up integrates very easily into that mob. So, and it makes the process a lot more less stressful. And it makes them grow evenly and that sort of process. Yeah.
A question we're often asked is, you know, colts, fillies. Any bias when you're trying to pinhook weanlings into yearling sales?
Obviously, I have a preference for colts because I find that's what we sort of really concentrate on. Obviously, if something goes wrong, we can't get to a yearling sale. We can take it to a trial stage, or therefore, yeah.
Yeah. And do you want to leave our guests here and viewing online with, you know, just one or two hints for if you're going into the pinhooking market?
Well, the best advice I could give everyone is get advice and good advice, especially if you're a little bit inexperienced. It goes a long way, and it reduces the risk.
Yeah. Look, just on that, you know, the English team, there's eight or nine of us in the bloodstock team, both in Sydney and Melbourne. You know, come tomorrow, come Sunday. If you're interested in buying horses to take through to yearling sales, we've sat down, we've looked at all the weanlings here, and what we're prepared to say is, you know, if we feel a certain horse can make a classic sale, a premier sale, an Easter sale, don't be afraid to come and ask us. We are here. The advice is free, and it certainly helps you, hopefully, make the right decision. Mark, thanks very much. Good luck on Sunday.
Thank you very much, and a privilege to be here.
Yeah, once again, if you've got questions for Mark, he'll be appearing later tonight. Might get Simon, Vivian and Chris Russell to come forward. So you've got your weanling, you've bred your weanling. It's getting close to sales entry time, and Simon and Rusty are going to talk to you a little bit about how you get the horse into your sale.
Thank you, Das. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you very much for joining us. Obviously, an important part of a breeding seminar is the recognition that many people are here to try and breed horses for commercial purposes, to try and sell them. And what we thought that Chris and I would talk about tonight is simply the fact that you've obviously been, with some of the previous speakers, you've been advised to control what you can control. And that comes down to what Pete was talking about when it comes to your stallion selection, what Das was speaking about with your broodmare selection, what Sam was talking about feeding and things like that. You have to exercise control over what you can control. And one of the things that is probably going to help you a little bit is understanding the selection process that Inglis goes to when we go to select horses into a yearling sale. By you understanding the way that we go about the selection process helps you make the round peg fit into the round hole. So what we're going to try and do is probably give you a bit of a quick run through on the way that we go about our selection for the respective primary yearling sales that we conduct. So perhaps, Rusty, we might start with just a time frame.
Is that on?
It is now.
Well, basically, it's, you know, a lot of people at home, they open their letterbox, you know, at the start of the year, and there's a catalogue, but it's a big build-up to get to that stage for us. And basically, the timeline for it is, you know, we take our entries up until early August and, you know, a little bit beyond that. Of course, it doesn't cost anything to nominate your yearling for a sale, and we as a team will inspect every yearling that is nominated. So entries are taken in the early August. We sit down and do our pedigree rating session, which is sort of late August once we've compiled all the entries. We'll go into a bit of detail that shortly. Inspections are done sort of September, October. the whole team in Sydney and Melbourne get out and do that. We make our decisions then. We send our letters of acceptance sort of late October, and then it's sort of up to us to talk to the studs, and they tell us sort of what yearlings we're going to take, and up to us to fight for the ones that we want to take. And basically our catalogues get sent to the printer about 3 months out from the sale. So we'll send, so our classic sales in February, we'll send that sort of 3 months before then and get it to the printers. Gives everyone a lot of time to get their catalogues and start doing their homework.
We do try to use, as a rough guide, a bit of a numerical ready reckoner. We score horses on paper. We score them with we give them a physical, a pedigree rating firstly out of from numbers 1 to 12, and then we give them a physical rating, a confirmation rating out of 80, which we'll speak about shortly. But the first part we're going to speak about is just the way that we go about this pedigree assessment, and that's where we all come to Sydney right at the end of August when most of the entries are in, and at that stage we sit down as a panel of about 11 people. We pull up every single pedigree. We actually do them, well, the first thing we probably do is we sit down and analyse and talk about all of the stallions that have yearlings represented. So, Rusty, perhaps we can talk. You can tell a little bit about the way that we go about the stallion assessment.
Yeah, well, it's basically we sort of got through the yearling sale session mainly now for this season. So we're already doing a lot of analysing with which stallions fitted where and, you know, which sold well and which stallions perhaps weren't as popular as others. So it's a good chance for us when we're all there to, in a group talk, and we talk to trainers about what horses they've got that are going well, and just try and use a bit of foresight as to what horses will be popular come the sales season, which is still another sort of 6 or 8 months away. So it's, we sit there and we talk about, you know, the new kids on the block, the first season stones, who we think is going to be popular, and we look at what numbers they've got and how many can we take for each sale. So it is a lot of talking, a lot of analysing of facts and figures and where we think each stallion sits in the realms of things.
The boys have said earlier how important stallion selection is, and we are, as exactly what Peter said, we are feeding a market that wants to consume a certain type of horse. So the stallion aspect is very, very much an important part of the discussion. In fact, the first day of our pedigree assessment is dedicated solely to stallion discussion, and that's where we're all getting various opinions. We're researching previous sales results. We get to get a feel for what the general market is feeling about stallions. We look at the numbers that they've got coming through. It's a very in-depth decision-making process when we go to analyse those stallions. Thereafter, once we've formed our opinion on where the stallions each individually sit through the commercial system, we then pull up all of the pedigrees. We actually do them on a sale-by-sale basis. So the first sale that we do start to analyse is, in fact, the Easter sale. But we pull them up and we do look at every entry that's come through into the Easter sale, but we do them all initially under the one sire. So if we have, for example, a horse like All-American, if there's 10 All-Americans, we do all of the All-Americans at the one time. And then if it happens to be all of the Pierrots, we do all of the Pierrots under that same set system. So every horse is looked at where we're effectively trying to compare apples with apples.
That's very important. For some of these stallions that serve massive books of mares, it's, you know, you don't want 100 of any certain sire in a sale, because if you're, you know, in the bottom 10 of those, then you're going to get left behind. So it's important looking at all the stallions progeny they've got and sort of bouncing one off the other and making sure you get the numbers right and give everyone the opportunity at the sale without flooding the market of any certain sire.
When we sit down and do this, when we sit down and analyse these types of things, as I mentioned at the start, we do score these horses on a scale of 1 to 12. Now, the way that we try and do it, it's roughly based around a numerical value based on the horse being of good average quality. And we pretty much structure on the basis of a 9, 10, 11 and 12 is of Easter quality. 7 and above would be of Premier quality. 4 and above would be of Classic quality. Now, that doesn't mean that a horse that scores a 9 automatically goes to Easter, because you as vendors might sit back and say that's a perfect horse to go to Classic or a perfect horse to go to Melbourne Premier. So we don't make that decision, but we do score them. When we look at it based around this numerical value, we do try and give these horses some sort of a pedigree rating, which means that when we go to the field, if you sit back and say to us, where would you see this horse best placed? We see it's perhaps scoring, say, an 8. We're probably inclined to sit back and say, look, that's probably going to be an Easter 2 or a Melbourne Premier horse. And that way you're getting a pretty clear indication straight away. So it's a fairly important part, isn't it, Chris, of the way we go about that assessment. We do, I can promise you, spend a lot of time discussing and arguing over these scores, and sometimes it's only a matter of 1 point, but we know how important this part of it is to your lives and your careers and every part of your annual income. So it's something that we take very, very seriously.
And the pedigree score is not the be-all and end-all either. You know, certain sires, say, for example, this year at Beneteau, like leading up to, he was a horse that, you know, might have been rated as high as he was, but he came out and got a lot of runners and winners, and it's something we we constantly analyse and adjust as horses come out and run, and you know, they get their stakes winners and whatnot. So it's not the be all and end all. It gives us a bit of a guide in the field as to where they sit. We can always go back and analyse pedigrees. You know, if we like one on type and think it falls a bit short, you know, we can adjust as it goes along. But just gives us a bit of a guide instead of going into the paddock with reams and reams of paper. Just as a stepping stone for us.
We get provided for all of the pedigrees. Just to give you an idea, we probably end up with just over 4,000 entries for Classic, Premier and Easter combined. So we actually have to go through quite a number of horses. And as I said, we do them sale by sale. But the actual pedigree that we receive through from our pedigree supplier, being Arion, gives us a little more information than would normally appear on a yearling catalogue. So we have previous sale prices, which gives us a chance to be able to analyse whether the pedigree is commercial. We get a chance to have a look at certain new updates. But once those initial pedigrees are produced, we then receive every single day updates for every one of those pedigrees from Arion. So we are constantly, from the time that we receive those, the first set of pedigrees, we are constantly updating pedigrees. So as Chris said, with a horse like Beneteau, young stallions coming through, when we start talking about horses' first season size in August and September, there hasn't even been two-year-old racing. So we have to be mindful of making adjustments, and we do that very, very seriously. So when we pull those pedigrees up, we actually pull it up on a screen similar to this, with a panel sitting in front of it, and we sit there and discuss it and effectively give every horse a rating, don't we?
Yeah, we discuss every horse. And again, you know, your young stones and full relations, half relations that come out, it constantly evolves, really. And then, you know, when it comes to the inspection side, we couple that with the type score, and that's when we started making our decision. But on the road is... It's a long process.
Very long process. We start the actual physical inspections. Most of the horses that get nominated for our sales, we've probably seen them 2, 3, or 4 times before we get to doing the official inspections. But the official inspections commence right at the end of September. Right at the end of August and the start of September. And we work right through September and October and to some degree into November. What we do is we've got effectively 2 teams in Melbourne and 3 teams in Sydney. We all split up. Try and work as much as we can in pairs, because it's always great to be able to bounce ideas off of each other. And those teams are not always the same team, so we do try and mix and mingle. So we're always getting differing opinions. Very important that we don't get too set in our ways with regards to, say, Rusty and myself being in the car all the time together. It doesn't work that way, so we're always switching around. It becomes very important that we do get this broad spectrum approach to every horse that we see. I think any idea what sort of kilometres we would do over that period of time?
I would say I'd be sitting in the car, I suppose, for those couple of months, 10 or 15,000 K, I suppose.
Multiply that out by 5 teams. So, you know, there's somewhere around about 60 or 70,000 kilometres are spent on the road. It's a job that we take very, very seriously. And it's something that when we do come to your farms to look at your yearlings, with that pedigree score already in place, we look at the score that we give the horse physically, which I'll ask Chris to explain in a second. And from that point, we actually can give you a pretty clear indication on what sale we see your horse best fitting from a commercial viewpoint. Rusty, perhaps just have a quick chat about the confirmation rating system that we use.
Well, it's a rating that we've used, which has evolved a couple of times, I think, over the past few years. But basically set now as a rating out of 80, but it pretty much centres around the number 50. And 50 we would consider just a good average type of horse. You know, it's pretty correct. It's got a lot going for it. No major defaults or anything there. So basically it's out of 50. And you go on from there. You know, a horse that might be a bit off the pace, if it's got a little offset knees or something, you might sort of deduct a few points and it might go down to a 45. And we couple that with the pedigree score, the type score it gets, and that's where we sort of work out where it fits sale-wise.
Mark Devcich was talking a little earlier about the importance of confirmation. We play exactly the same game. For all the people that are in the room that have in fact played the pinhook game, you know now what you're out looking for when you're out looking at these weanlings that are going to go through the sale on Sunday. When you do that, you're trying to determine whether that horse is going to develop. We do exactly the same thing. What's important from our viewpoint and so essential now is the way that the horses are presented to us when we go to do those inspections. We have in the past had people that try and run them out in paddocks up to their knees and hocks in long grass, and we can't see club feet and we make decisions that are incorrect. Honestly, for me, the most important day you're going to encounter is the day that you're selling that horse in that ring out there, or the one that we have at Oaklands in Melbourne. The second most important day is the day that we actually come and look at the horse, because we want to be able to assess it accurately, be totally fair, be totally honest with you. If we miss a fault because of a circumstance of being out in a paddock with horses running around and things like that, we don't get a chance to assess the horse properly. The horse might be put into a sale that is doesn't fit into, and ultimately it becomes an expensive exercise for you as a vendor. So what we do ask as much as possible is that horses do get caught and led. So we have a chance to look at them and be totally fair to the horse and be totally fair and honest with you. I think that's probably one of the things that has evolved over the last few years. And we thank every vendor in anticipation, given that that's not that far away, that you know the way that they can be presented to us does honestly help us make an accurate assessment that helps you get a better result.
And they've spoken about what we look for early, you know, it's just the strength, size, whether they're correct, the bone and substance that they've got. That leads us to give our score, and we couple that with our pedigree score, and that leads us then to be able to make our decision, which a lot of the time can be done in the paddock if they meet the certain thresholds that we feel are adequate for a sale. And then, you know, some horses need a bit of debating after that.
Again, we spoke a little earlier, or the boys spoke earlier, about the way that the importance of stallions, the importance of female family. But clearly, when it comes to a yearling sale, the importance of confirmation is absolutely paramount. So whilst I said we had this ready wreck in the situation, let's say that a horse scores a 7 on pedigree and a 50 on confirmation, that basically becomes a perfect Melbourne Premier type horse. Or a horse scores a 9 and a 55, becomes an automatic horse for Sydney Easter. But what we also do is we do bend the rules when it comes to horses that have got outstanding confirmation, and we've proved it over the years that the confirmation factor is just so important when it comes to the sale ring. We would rather be taking a 4 and a 60 into Premier than a 10 and a 45 or a 10 and a 40. So again, the ability for us for us to be able to make a totally correct assessment of the horse is so important. Confirmation, I promise you, is now paramount it's paramount with all of your pin hookers. It's absolutely paramount with all of your buyers, and we have to play that rule as well. So sometimes you can be dealt a rough card. You send your mare to an expensive stallion. You send a valuable mare. If you get a physical product that's not up to the cut of making either Easter or a selected sale, otherwise, you've just unfortunately got to understand that. We will do our best to explain to you, but I promise you that the one thing that is absolutely vitally important is we try and get a lineup of horses that we are so proud to have on the complex, on our respective sales complexes.
Yeah, so I think, as Darce alluded to a few years ago, it might have been more pedigree was more important than type. We, in all the analysing we do after the sales and then through the sales result, is that type rules all. Type can outsell a pedigree. I know James Mitchell, one of the guys, did a run down to southern New South Wales on his own and came back in raptures about this Turfontaine colt. Now it was only a 3 on pedigree, which was far inferior, but they wanted to send it to Melbourne. He said it's a good enough sort. I think it went and made 110,000 or something, you know, which it just proves, and, you know, the physicals that we see early doors that are we think are the cracking types, they're always the one you find at the top of the result sheet.
Modesty prevents Chris from actually admitting to one that he actually found this year, that it was a horse in an I Am Invincible colt that he found at Yarraman and went through. Chris was probably on paper, he was probably a level below or 2 levels below being an Easter horse. Rusty saw the horse, thought he was absolutely outstanding, encouraged Harry and Arthur to put the horse into Easter. They did so, came up with a result of $750,000. So again, it's an evidence of the importance of confirmation. I think the other thing that's probably worth us just saying is that we are actually in this with you. We want that the greater success that you guys have selling your product is obviously it results back to us as well, because we are commission agents. So we're actually in this together, and we are there to help you in any way we can. Sometimes I think it's been perhaps seen that, you know, the various sales companies might be seen as slightly as the enemy or negative or something like that. That's clearly not the way it is. We want to steer you down the path where your best commercial returns are going to come. We do. We are very much an open book when it comes to discussions about where we think that horses are best going to fit, and that will be based around where we see the horse best sold. And clearly, to give you a very quick example, there was a horse that was sold earlier this year at the Gold Coast Magic Million sale, made $80,000. The other day it went through a Melbourne Vobis Gold supplementary section and made $90,000. Now, there's no question that the Gold Coast sellers are stronger than the supplementary at Melbourne for Vobis Gold, but what it was the horse became a standout in a sale. So sometimes where we might recommend that a horse go into what you might consider to be a lesser sale, we would be doing it because we believe that's where you might get your best return.
Yeah, we don't go out in the field to make enemies, but a lot of the time, you know, we don't like to disappoint people, but there's probably no worse disappointment than a horse going through a sale ring and not achieving the goals. You know, you put so much time and effort into these horses, and for them to be put in the wrong sale can really hurt, and hurt financially. We don't want to see people go out of the game or anything like that. So that's why we do our best to steer people in the right. And at the end of the day, you know, theoretically, we work on commission, so if you win, we win, and that's, you know, we want to see everyone get a good result.
at any stage where you would like to have a chat to any of the English boys about our rating system, we don't need to be too pleased to do it. The best time is probably when we are on the farms. We are quite happy to sit there and discuss it. So please feel free to ask us any questions that you would like us to be able to, or that you would like us to answer. We do our level best to be able to do so. Guys, hope that gives you a bit of an idea of the way that we do it. It is a very thorough, very in-depth, and very serious process that we take on. We understand how important it is to you and your livelihood. So it's a process that we do take on with a great deal of caution and care. Thanks for your time. And I think Darce is now, Sam Fairgray and Peter O'Brien are going to have a chat to you now about yelling presentation. Thanks, guys.
Peter O'Brien is the stud manager at Sejan Ho Farm up in Scone. It's an adjustment property, has a lovely band of mares. And Peter and I are just going to have a bit of a chat about, firstly, the yearling preparation, and then once you get to the sale, what is required. So, Pete, when you've had Joe Bloggs buy a weanling at the sale and sends it up to the farm, and then you bring it in for the yearling prep, what are you trying to achieve in that yearling prep?
I think the most important thing is obviously what's been discussed earlier on is deciding what sale it goes to. Obviously, yearlings that are going to, like Magic Millions, are classic. The sale's a lot earlier, so we generally try and pick a more, it's like an August, September foal that has substance. With the later sales with Melbourne and Easter, you can you have more room for manoeuvre as far as with size and scope and development. When the yearlings come in for prep, Magic Million sources, we generally give them, that's roughly about 10 weeks. Because they're younger horses, you can't do as much with them, so they get a sort of gentle prep more than that. The Easter horses, where they're 18 months, you can do a lot more work with them.
Sure. So once you've got them in prep, are there any special tricks you do as far as making sure that horse is going to get through the preparation without any hitches, as far as making sure it's going to eat well and that sort of thing?
I think probably the most important thing is having the right people. Having the right people on your farm for yearlings is vital. That's when particularly big Easter colts can get away in you with their temperaments. I'm a big believer in mouthing the horses properly, and I think that's something that sort of dropped by the wayside the last sort of 10 years. So we make sure they're mouthed properly. We won't clip them up to their bits till we're happy that they can handle the bit properly. And then we generally, the first couple of weeks, obviously, you're just mouthing and rugging and easing them into the prep. For example, with Easter horses, when we get going with them, like they could have up to 2 hours walking a day plus lunging. But the vital thing with yearlings is you have to remember they're only babies. And I know it's a well-worn thing, but I mean, they are individuals, and it's you have to treat each yearling as an individual. And for example, you're talking about like horse walkers, for example, a lot of people, now this can be dictated by your farm, and smaller farms just can't fiscally hire or have enough staff to do it, and they put them on horse walkers. I and our team at Sejan are big believers in hand walking, so they will go on a horse walker twice a day, but they'll also get a lot of hand walking on grass, and we also put rollers and side reins on them. And for people who don't know what that's about, it's basically, particularly we had a couple of fillies Threeser this year that were quite long and narrow and light through their middles, and if you put a roller on them, it gets their neck down and basically builds up all the muscles on their back, and particularly through their hips. Another sort of thing with horse walkers is the surface. If you've got a sort of firm surface on your horse walker, and you have a horse that toes in, you can end up with a very jointy ankles. So horses with bad deviations, we generally would never put on a horse walker.
Sure. And as far as the diet when the horse comes into prep, obviously it's been out in a paddock where it's had free access to pastures and also getting grain and so forth. When it comes into prep, obviously that those pastures are taken away. So how do you formulate the diet for a yearling in a prep?
Again, we're a little bit old-fashioned. I sort of still give them a mash, and I'd like to see young yearlings at mashes. We keep them really on the same feed they're out in the paddock. until we start increasing their exercise. Again, it's a bit old-fashioned. We use a lot of boiled barley, and then we use certain products that are would be low in starch but high in energy, sort of feed supplements. Again, tailored to the each individual horse. Like, for example, at one of our colts at Easter this year was on 14 kilos of feed a day because of the amount of exercise we had to give him, we had to feed him accordingly, where you could have a filly who could be on 6 kilos a day. But again, it's tailoring the diet to the animal.
Sure, so balancing the diet with the exercise and the physicals of the horse. And when I say the physicals are the conformation and how heavy the horse is through the body or how light it is through the body, can you over-exercise? Can it you cause problems with over-exercising?
Absolutely, yeah. And again, it's all fairly obvious, but like if you've got a horse, yearlings at that stage of their life can have epiphysitis in their knees. So if you have a yearling that's back of the knee, loaded shoulders, and has epiphysitis in its knees, obviously that we lunge horses, but we'd never lunge a horse like that. And most of the horses, animals like that we would just hand walk only. And again, if they've got epiphysitis, you back off on the feed a bit, try and get them lighter. Because, I mean, at the end of the day, even though you're trying to get a result in the sales ring, we're all just trying to breed athletes. And you don't want to, they're only teenagers, so they have the growing pains and things. And if you've got a yearling and it's showing you that it's not handling its exercise, back off. Some of our yearlings, we just stop and leave them out all day for 3 or 4 days just to give them a little break.
Absolutely, and that's the important thing. They are still young and grown and developing, so being able to assess each horse as an individual and make the requirements for its exercise in that way. Now also, Pete, obviously when you're getting them prepared for the sale, you want to get their coats nice and shiny. How important is the grooming process, do you think?
I think it's vital, and it's like another thing that seems to have been dropped by the wayside over the last 10 years since when I started in Ireland. We'd groom for 2.5 hours a day, an hour in the morning, an hour and a half in the afternoon. You'd end up like Popeye after. It's not only for their coat, Sam, but it's also for their muscle tone, and it's more or less like a massage for some of them. And as you know yourself, when you groom a horse, they'll fall asleep while you're doing it. Some people think by feeding more oil and double rugging and things, which obviously does help their coats, but I'm a big believer in grooming, and not only, I think just the animals love it, and it's another thing for them to relax.
Absolutely, it's very important, I think, grooming, because it also, if your staff are grooming them and the horse is a bit tight or sore somewhere, that's where they'll be able to pick it up, and that's where you'll be able to fix that, you know, going forward to help the horse feel comfortable and be presented at the sale in the best possible way. Now, thinking ahead to going to the sale, what sort of things can you do on the farm as far as preparing your horse for when it gets down to the, you know, sale? Because obviously there's going to be lots of people wanting to inspect the horse, and you want to present it in the best possible fashion and the buyer to like the horse. So what can you do on the farm to help when you actually get to the sale?
Every time a horse comes, yearling comes out of the stable, they're stood before they go out to the paddocks in the morning, or they're stood and by all the lads and taught to stand properly. When they go out to the horse walker, they're all stood for a minute so that the yearlings are educated as far as standing correctly. There's nothing worse than being at a yearling sale and buyers have that tiny little window to see the horse, and there's a groom having their hand pushing it back and forward, and the horse should be, the presentation is everything, as you know, and having someone standing there, standing back from the horse, not at their mouth, presenting the horse nice and balanced is what it's all about. When we walk them, again, we'll always walk them around our parade ring where we're going to show them for clients, so they get used to that. And then just before we have the intense parades, for example, before Easter, the 2 weeks leading up where we'd have sort of 3 or 4 parades a day, we'll actually bring all the staff and the farm out and have a couple of parades in front of them just to get the horses used to parading in front of people.
Absolutely, and it's not only the horses that need the practice, it's also the staff. There's a lot of staff that probably haven't had that experience of showing a horse at the sale, and it's been able to get them confident and know the right techniques to show off that horse at the sale time and help to increase that horse's value for the vendors. Pete, are there any other little tricks and things that you might have found in Ireland and that you still use today in preparing a yearling?
I'd love to say yes, but not really. But I think the main thing is not only educating the horse, but educating the people on the farm as well. As Jody's here, would know, we had a particularly unruly colt for Easter this year, and it's a matter of tailoring the yearlings to the people you have, and having that sorted before you get to the sales. Sometimes you get to the sales and you'll just see this big unruly colt with maybe a young 16-year-old girl, and it's not being sexist, but she just doesn't have the strength to stand over the horse. So you should have all that sorted out before you get to the sales. Again, like little things, when you're traveling the horses, we'll all travel them beside the horse they were stable with. And then when they get to the stables, we'll always have them beside the horses they are stable with on the farm, so they settle. I think it's vital to get here as early as possible. So you give the animals a chance to parade, get used to their environment, take them out 3 or 4 times a day before it gets busy, so they get used to obviously the new environment and other animals around them.
I think hand walking is highly underestimated by a lot of people in the industry. It's one thing that I've found with my experience, that it educates the horse so much to relax beside the leader, so that when you get to the sale, the horse and the leader are confident and they go together as one. And you can't spend enough time hand walking a yearling. Obviously the exercise part of it is good, but it's also that unison between the leader and the horse, and the confidence and both of the handler and the horse being comfortable together.
And I think it's I agree, Sam, and everybody knows, but the people who don't, when a horse drops its head is when they actually walk properly. So if you've got a horse that's not mouthed properly, and the person leading it isn't educated properly, or the partnership isn't right, and the horse has its head in the air, it's not going to stride out properly, and it's not going to show itself to its full ability. And I'm a big believer in putting braking rollers and side reins on, which actually teaches the horse to drop its neck. And not only is it good for that, but it also puts manners on the horses nice and early.
Great. You spoke about trucking them down here next to their mate, and then obviously when they arrive here in the stables, being settled in to a familiar horse next door to them. What are the things you might do on a first day at a sale as far as preparing the horse for those first parade days?
Just, giving them as much exercise. Like, you have to remember they're used to getting 2.5, some of them 3 hours of exercise a day. They get to the sales and then they're getting nothing bar sort of a 20-minute walk in the morning. So you have to balance. So the first day we'd give them a lot of walking. We'd walk them for 1.5 hours, just again for education to the environment, but also because they're used to so much exercise, they can get fresh very quickly. We'd back off their feed, lessen the grain, and just give them a nice stable diet until they start parading. And as everybody knows, the yearlings get very, very tired after a day's parading, and then you just increase your feedback up again, always trying to balance that they're showing themselves to the best ability.
Sure. How long before the actual sale starts do you like to be on the sale ground?
Generally, about here, about 7 days, a week.
Sure.
And I just think, I see some farms and they come in on the Friday or Saturday before Easter, and I just think that by then they're behind the eight ball a bit, because not only we would have had, just say, for example, 50 parades by then, they're going to have 50 parades in one day, and the horses have just arrived, so they haven't acclimatized, and they're going to get hammered by all these people. And you're just better for, I know it's a cost thing, so in fairness to smaller farms, the cost of accommodation things for the lads can be a factor as well, but in an ideal scenario, a good week beforehand.
Absolutely, but the cost against a buyer being interested in that horse is, it outweighs it very, very easily, because you've got that small window of opportunity. When you pull that horse out of the box, you want that horse to come out, to stand, to be alert, and then when the potential buyer asks you to walk that horse, it walks along smoothly and strides out. If it comes out and it's jumping around, is all over the place, he or she can't have a decent look at the horse, and he straight away, that's going to be a cross against that horse. So you want to have that horse, when it first comes out of the box, be ready to go. So it's get to the sale grounds early. It does definitely help. I know at Arrowfield, we always used to get down nice and early just so the horses get settled in, get familiarised with the grounds and so forth.
I think the key, if you think about it, like for us, the total cost of our accommodation at Easter is one bid on one horse in the ring. So it's really, particularly at Easter, I think it's the cost saving is minimal.
Sure. When people come to inspect the yearlings, do you try and talk to them? Do you leave them alone? What do you find is the best technique? Obviously, they're here. They've got their list. They know what horse they want to look at. So do you talk to them? Do you give them information? What do you find is the best technique?
I think the best. I used to go around to Demi O'Byrne and was at Coolmore, and as a particularly annoying vendor came up one day and she said, "Demi, how'd you like to see the horses?" And he said, "In silence." I think the people are there to see the horses. They have the catalogue page in front of them. Unless there's an update since the catalogue was printed, I leave them alone. I mean, they know what they're looking at. They've got everything in front of them. For me, if I look at a horse and there's a vendor yapping in my ear telling me about this, that, and the other, it's a different story. Now, that's for yearling sales. But at broodmare sales, and particularly broodmares, I mean, you would obviously talk a bit more, particularly about the mare's offspring, what type of foals she throws. And a lot of people want to know, if they're interested in the mare, what stallion suits her.
Yeah, that's right. They need to have their full concentration when they're looking at these horses, because they're spending thousands of dollars. So they want to have full concentration, and probably it is best once they finish the parade. If you want to mention something about your horses or ask them a question, leave it till the end. You can obviously ask them what they liked and what they thought and so forth to get some feedback, because that's always important. But I think a lot of the time they do prefer to be left alone while they're actually inspecting the horses.
I think everyone does. I don't know. I'd find anybody who would like someone there yapping in the rear when they're looking at a horse.
Yeah, sure. Well, that's the end of our section. So thanks very much. And we're going to hand it over to Jonathan Lumsden and James Price, who are going to discuss X-rays. Thank you.
So you've listened to Jonathan Darcy on which mare to choose. You've then spoken to Peter Hegney on which stallion is best. You've spent all that time foaling down the mare. You've spent 2 hours a day grooming this foal or this yearling leading into the sale. And then that dreaded day of the vet turning up to take the x-rays. Please welcome Dr. Jonathan Lumsden from REC.
Thanks, James. It's a pleasure to be here, even if I am representing the dreaded vets out there.
Jonathan, very simple question for all of us. Obviously, most of us are not veterinarians in here. Is it true, is a set of x-rays a pass or a fail?
Simple answer is no. The reality is that both the veterinarians and buyers and also vendors would love to say that it is. But there's a lot of reasons why it isn't a yes or no, and there's a lot of reasons why it's good that it's not yes or no. I think probably just to put it in perspective, the x-ray process of taking surveys and repository x-rays, which are the x-rays that go with the yearling or weanling to the sale, in terms of the buying and selling of thoroughbred horses in Australia, is actually a relatively new phenomenon. I mean, it's now coming up to about 15 years that we've been doing that. We're new internationally, but in terms of the whole process, it's new. And we have come in a long way in that time frame. But the reason that it's not a yes or no answer there are a couple of reasons for that. One is that certainly the x-rays themselves, although everyone says they are black and white, they're actually not. They're shades of grey, and they actually represent pretty complex anatomy and changes going on in the horse. The main reason that it really isn't a yes or no is that it really depends on why you are asking that veterinarian to look at the radiographs, and particularly when we're looking at thinking about a weanling and a broodmare sale compared to a yearling sale, there are very different reasons why you have the x-rays examined by a veterinarian if you're selling or buying a weanling versus a yearling, because you've got two purposes. One is potentially is that you're going to on-sell that horse, and the other is that you, particularly in a yearling situation, that you're principally looking for a racehorse. The other factor is that the majority of horses, in terms of their x-rays, the majority of them actually have pretty normal x-rays, and none of those faults are particularly important in terms of affecting the horse as a racehorse. But the things that need to be considered are any of those things likely to affect that horse actually becoming lame or having a problem but are also there are certain conditions that they can have that may cause them to become lame or have a problem, but don't necessarily mean that they won't be a successful racehorse. And there also are a whole range of conditions that actually can be managed and the horses grow out of. So all those factors need to be taken into account when a veterinarian's looking at the films and deciding, you know, what information you want to get from the x-rays.
And when we're obviously at a weanling sale here, but when we're at yearling sales, you would obviously have a number of clients you would look for. And is it true that one client you know would ask you, I want a two-year-old, therefore that horse has to have a clean set of x-rays. But if it has an issue, you might have another client who's looking for a horse that's going to give it time, or it might be a filly with breeding record. So you would probably then give differing opinions depending on what that client wants.
Yeah, that's right. That's another factor that goes into the whole process that doesn't make it a clear yes or no factor, is because certainly the relationship and the communication that you have between the buyer and the veterinarian is very important. As I said at the outset, they need to know, you know, what you're hoping to get out of it, how do you want to use that information, and the veterinarian's also got to take into account, you know, how is that person likely to use it, particularly, you know, if there are certain conditions that we know with time and with appropriate management, if they're given a delayed breaking in, say 4 to 6 months, there's every likelihood that they'll be a late two-year-old or a successful three-year-old, and that may be suitable to certain people, where there are other conditions that are not that forgiving and won't be able to respond to that time. And typically, if you have an owner that or a potential buyer that does want a two-year-old, that horse is maybe not as appropriate for him as someone that's prepared to wait as a three-year-old or a little older.
Now, most commercial breeders do survey x-rays on a young horse between 8 and 11 months of age, usually July and August. What are the faults of which are most serious to observe at this time?
Well, I think probably what's important is to remember is, this goes back to the actual onset of the x-raying, is that and this goes also back to why you're actually x-raying the horses, whether it's to on-sell them as a potential racehorse later on, or whether you're looking to buy them as a racehorse now, is that the majority of problems associated with lameness and performance-affecting conditions that we actually see on the racehorse are typically related to exercise-related injuries, that is, you know, osteoarthritis and knee chips and fetlock chips. And I'm sure most of you are aware that in reality, both in weanlings and yearlings, those types of conditions are not typically, they're very unusually seen at that age. So getting to your question, I mean, mainly what we're seeing at the weanling and late weanling stage is the most concern are horses that have developed osteochondrosis, or OCD as it's commonly known, which is where the cartilage and bone in the major joints doesn't form properly and typically creates fragments. And yes, they can go and cause problems later on, but they're certainly amenable at that stage to being either managed medically or managed surgically, so that when the horse does go on to the yearling stage in another 4 to 5 months, it's in a much better state in terms of being presented and sold, and also subsequently it's in a much better state that it's likely to stand up to the rigours of racing as a 2 and 3 year old.
When a horse is presented at sale, the x-rays are taken within 42 days of that sale. If faults come up on those x-rays, can anything be done to improve that horse's saleability?
In general, the answer is no, and that's probably a testament to the fact that, and that's a very valuable answer, because that's a testament to the fact of the authenticity of what you're selling as a vendor and what you're buying as a buyer, is that given that time frame of 6 weeks from the time of sale, it's unlikely that there's going to be any significant development abnormalities, which is what we're talking about at that age group, apart from the unexplainable and unusual things such as a traumatic accident that can occur any time after you x-ray the horse. And that's principally why that time frame was taken. It was so that the buyers and the sellers can genuinely present the horse as the most practical and reasonable representation of what the horse has got. There are lumps and bumps and other soft tissue injuries that you can manage, but in terms of the x-rays, very little that you do in that 42-day period will change what's presented at the sale.
So when no change, does that, are your thoughts going back to the way horses are fed all the way through and that sort of thing? What's your sort of advice as a veterinarian to, in terms of how you feed that horse and also exercise to help reduce the number of, you know, possible faults that will appear on the x-rays?
Yeah, well, I think as Peter and Sam alluded to earlier, the reality is that by the time a weanling is presented for its survey weanling, or, well, weanling x-rays or survey x-rays for yearling, the effect of nutrition and exercise has principally had its effect, and that occurs through the nutrition and exercise of the mare right through to the foaling process and the weaning process. So at that, they're the times where horses need, you know, balanced protein, energy, and appropriate minerals and supplements, and also a moderate exercise program. There has been some very interesting work that's been done on the effect of exercise, particularly in foals and weanlings, and most of it's been done in North America, but a lot of it suggests that the incidence of OCD lesions, or where there's this failure of the bone and the cartilage to form properly, is increased when these young horses have a reduced exercise program, typically locking them up, and in smaller and more confined areas tends to typically increase the chances of that happening, as does excessive amounts of energy as well.
Do, in your opinion, do x-rays tell the whole story, or are you a veterinarian who really likes to go and look at the horse physically as well to try and advise on a greater scale rather than just what the x-rays in the repository suggest?
Yeah, it's interesting, and once again, it's a little bit is tailored on the individual that you're representing, and that depends a little bit on their, and particularly in our environment, particularly when it comes to not only weanlings but also yearlings. The majority of people that are selecting weanlings or yearlings are, as yourselves are experienced, they're either trainers, bloodstock agents, breeders, who are very capable, probably more capable than the majority of veterinarians, of making an assessment of conformation, which is a very important part as to how whatever's on an x-ray is going to affect the horse long term. There are other people that require that assistance in terms of providing an overall image and interpretation of the horse, and for that it is very useful. On the whole, and this is the value of the radiographs will typically show more than you will see physically. It's more likely that you'll look at a horse's fetlock and say, that's a completely normal looking fetlock, it's well conformed, and then you'll go and talk to your veterinarian and say, well, how are those x-rays on the radiograph? And he would say, well, it's got, you know, quite a severe sesamoiditis, or it's got a chronic fracture off the top of one of the sesamoids. We would then go and look at the horse and say, well, you know, clearly the person looking at the horse has missed that. You go and look at it, and they're right. You know, conformationally, it's correct, and it's got a normal-looking fetlock. So it's a balance between the knowledge of the person that's asking you to look for it. There are also particularly additional other things, such as whether, you know, the injury that you're seeing on radiographs, whether it be arthritis or a chip fragment, you know, is that associated with some filling in the fetlock? Is associated with some filling in a hock or a stifle? That's the role that I see the veterinarians have, to go and look specifically at those areas where someone who's experienced looking at weanlings or yearlings says, you know, that doesn't look quite right. I don't quite know what it means, but, you know, I'd like you to give me an interpretation of it.
The technology for looking at x-rays has obviously come a long way from holding a screen up in front of a light to view them. What are the new technologies coming through to help and make it clearer for you as a veterinarian to read the radiographs?
Yeah, well, there's no doubt about that the technology in medical imaging in the last 15 years has come an enormous way. I can remember like it was yesterday, almost 15 years ago, when the first set of survey radiographs were required in yearling thoroughbreds, precipitated by the Hong Kong Jockey Club, and we had not hundreds, but, you know, certainly tens of horses in our clinic, x-raying horses and taking, you know, over an hour a horse to x-ray it, developing the film on wet film, looking it up on the screen, to now, with the advent of digital radiology, which has been around for the last, you know, 5 to 7 years, where a veterinarian that's efficient x-raying a horse can do the process in about 20 minutes and provide superior quality and a much better indication of exactly, you know, what the joints looks like, and a much better and more accurate representation if there's any developmental problem or any pathology going on. So it's come a long way in providing a more time-efficient, cost-efficient, and a more accurate way of looking at the horse's skeleton, that's for sure. The other thing that's become particularly valuable with that, which you know Inglises are very aware of here, is the value to be able to look at these films online. You know, and that's provided not only quality radiographs, but also has opened that ability to obviously a far greater sphere of veterinarians to be able to provide an opinion. They can also go back and repeat views that they're not happy with as well, whereas before it used to be a major process. So what's available now is probably, it's when you go to a human hospital, the digital radiology that you'll see here in the sales ground is as good, if not better, than what you'll experience at your local hospital.
Jonathan, what advice can you give breeders in the room if they're looking to pinhook a weanling on Sunday?
Well, obviously, in relation to, specifically in regards to the radiographs, I think it goes back to what we mentioned before, is I think the first and foremost thing is I think as a purchaser, you have to have a goal of what you're aiming to get out of the purchase. And now, if that is a pinhooking process, then obviously there are several factors that come into play with that. And one of those will be when... you're looking to on-sell that horse. So there's the time frame that, as was mentioned before, there's obviously, that Peter was saying, there's significant differences in the prepping of horses for early sales, and it's the January, February sales versus the Easter sales and June sales. And that's important because when, from an x-ray point of view, when you go to look at those x-rays, some of those, overall about 30 to 40% of horses will have some change on their x-rays. That doesn't mean that they're an abnormality. There's a very small number that are quite serious. And then in between, there's a range of mild to moderate conditions. Also in that range, some of those changes are developmental, and a lot of those horses will grow out of those conditions. And so that is important in terms of discussing, you know, when you're talking, looking at to pinhook horses and the veterinarian is relaying to you that there is a developmental problem, you need to ask them, well, what's the sort of time frame, and what can I expect when I go to the yearling sales in February and April? You know, the other thing you need to know is that also if there are abnormalities which are pathological that are typically OCD, is there anything we can do about them? And if there is something we can do about them, whether it be a management control or a medical treatment or a surgical treatment, you know, what's the time frame? What sort of time frame will that give us if our goal is to reach a certain sale? So I think knowing exactly, you know, what your goals for and in terms of what the ultimate outcome will be from those x-rays in terms of its effect on the finances and its economic impact going through the sale is also important. And that comes with, you know, the discussion and the relationship, you know, with the veterinarian. And the beauty is now, after this amount of time period, there is a vast array of veterinarians who've got a lot of experience in that area now.
Just a couple of things that I thought would be worthwhile mentioning just from looking after the repository for the last few years is us as individuals, our greatest... It's our nature to fear what we don't know. And I think radiographs can be a lot, especially for breeders, we actually don't understand them. So what I ask you to do when your vet is at your farm and when they're taking radiographs, so I encourage you to ask as many questions, and they might be really stupid. I've asked many stupid questions down in that repository, but they may be really stupid to us, sorry, to the veterinarian, but the more you know about your x-rays, the better experience you're going to have in the sale ring. Because the better you're going to understand what the vets are viewing down there and how they're assessing your horse. So if you know how they're assessing your horse, that gives you a better opportunity to set a reserve that's more realistic and for you to sell that horse. The other thing also is radiographs, they obviously can be as subjective as I like one horse and Chris Russell doesn't like the horse. So it can be a little bit like that in the repository. Would you agree?
Absolutely, absolutely. It's a grayscale, and that has got pluses because that variation in opinion means that, you know, particularly if you're selling, if your veterinarian says, well, look, you know, this horse has got such and such a condition, and I think it's going to have an effect on the horse, and I think, and what we typically do, similar to the rating scale that you use in different other parts of evaluating the horses, we come up with a subjective rating scale as to the likelihood of a certain lesion having an effect, and that's typically broken down to a very simplistic as a low risk, a moderate risk, and a high risk of having a certain effect, whether it be on it affecting its lameness, whether it be on affecting it as a racehorse, or whether it be the effect it would have in the sales room economically. And that last point is basically an interpretation by a veterinarian is how are other veterinarians likely to view that, which is probably from a vendor's point of view is particularly important, as you say, in setting a reserve, is, you know, how do you feel that particular radiographic change in that horse's conformation with the likely goal of that horse, how is that likely to be viewed by the majority of veterinarians?
And because there is a bit of a grayscale, what I suggest to you is once the x-rays are taken, your vet gives you a report to say how they are and if they're low risk or moderate risk or high risk. What I suggest is don't take what they say as gospel, because it is grey, and if there is an issue, I would urge you to actually get another veterinarian, pay another veterinarian, call Jonathan and say, Jonathan, I own lot 100, I'm selling it. Can I get your independent assessment of it? Okay, because it can then come back and be a little bit different, or they might pass it, or it might fall back into the low range, or it might increase into the moderate range. And all this is just helped to, designed to help you set your reserve and hopefully then sell the horse in the sale ring.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right, because in the interpretation, probably 80% of the interpretation that the veterinarian has is based on his or her experience. The other 20% is what's factual information in the literature, and the reality is that there's a real paucity of good, hard quality literature to say this particular lesion will result in this horse, this economic impact on this horse in the ring versus this degree of lameness versus this effect on the racehorse. Those numbers are just never going to be known because there are so many variables affected. But we do it in our practice. I mean, we've got a large number of veterinarians, and I've been looking at them for a long time, and constantly for all the films, I will always ask two or three other people, you know, how would you rate this lesion? And we do it within our own practice, and it's a sensible thing to get multiple veterinarians. And one of the great things that Inglises have done is engaged the services of Dr. Stephen Hance, which some of you may have heard of, who is one of the leading authorities from Kentucky in the USA. And that's provided a great leveler, and just what James was saying, provides veterinarians with a balance of opinion when they're trying to decide the significance of what they see on a radiograph.
Dr. Lumsden, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Jonathan Darcy, to continue.
Thanks, Dr. Great.
Welcome back to us.
We're coming to the closing stages. So I can see everyone's tongues out waiting for a drink. So fear not, it's only 5 or 10 minutes away.
Just a couple of things from a vendor point of view, just understanding how it works up there in the box there. As far as setting a reserve, what is the information that a vendor needs and that you need to assist them to set the right reserve?
Well, Caroline, I think it's one aspect of the sales process. I mean, you've heard all about the raising of the horse, and it's that 18 months, 2 years. It's a long time to get the horse to walk into the sale, whether it's here or in Melbourne, wherever it is. So it's a very important day. It's a day that's nerve-wracking, and we know for the breeders that are in the room, it's grand final day. You know, all that investment, all that hard work and effort that's gone into to raising the horse is going to be realised, hopefully, in that sale ring. So setting a reserve, I mean, obviously, you've got an opinion of what you'd like to get. It's cost you a certain amount of money. But at the end of the day, the things you've got to take into account are how popular has the horse been in its inspection. So, look, at various sales, you're going to get quite a lot of people coming around. And, of course, it's great when you've got Gay Waterhouse and David Hayes and Mick Price and all the country trainers and all the agents coming around looking at your horse and saying nice things. What I'd urge you to do is watch how many times they come back a second time, and they might bring a client back or bring someone around for a second opinion. You know, the majority of people buying horses will not only look once, they'll probably look two or three times. You know. The exception to that is Peter Moody, who I know only looks once, but you know, the majority of buyers you'll see will go two or three times. So that's one indication. The second indication, as you've heard James and Dr. Lumsden talk about, is the repository. Now, if it's a sale where you've got x-rays at the repository, you do have the ability as a vendor to go and get a readout of which veterinarians have been looking at the x-rays. Now, at the upper end of the scale, sort of, you know, Magic Millions, Premier, Easter, you're going to see most people, if they're spending, you know, upwards of $50,000, they're going to go and look at those x-rays. And if you've got between, you know, five,
10, 15 views on the x-rays, you're going to have a pretty good sale. That's a pretty good indication that there's plenty of interest in your horse. If at those sort of sales you're only getting one or two or three hits at the x-rays, it's probably an indication your horse is not that popular, and so you've probably got to, you know, take that into consideration when you're setting a reserve. The other thing I'd suggest is have a look, you know, hopefully if your horse is a little bit later in the sale, have a look how the progeny of the stallion is selling in the sale. As I said, it's all about fashion. You know, a horse that was popular in January, come Easter time, might be a little bit less popular, and vice versa. So, you know, if you've got one by a stallion that's got, you know, multiple entries in the sale, just pay attention to the sale. How's the sale going? How's the clearance rate? You know, what's selling well? And I think that does give you a fair idea, Caroline, about how to set the reserve. The one other thing I would suggest is, as I said, you know, the auctioneers will come around and look at your horse. They'll probably come around the morning that they're selling the horse and, you know, ask what your opinion is, ask if there's anything extra, you know, you'd like mentioned when we're selling the horse. We do value the horses, you know, as part of our job. We'll give you an idea. Now, most of the vendors who have dealt with me in the past will say that I'm Mr. Unders, but there's a reason for that, because I'd rather be wrong, you know, on the upside than, you know, over evaluate a horse and then, you know, be disappointed, see you disappointed when the horse doesn't reach that sort of expectation. So we will certainly be in a position to be able to give you an idea of what we think the horse could be worth.
A lot of people in the room have obviously sold horses, so you understand how this works, but a lot of people probably don't. We see the vendor getting up and chatting with the auctioneer or chatting with some of the English staff. What actually is going on in that box up there, and what's the process that's undertaken when the vendor steps up? What do you want to know? What does the vendor have to tell you?
Okay, Carol, it's a little bit different to other auctions in that obviously with the likes of jewellery or art, there's a reserve card placed in probably a day or two before the auction starts, so there's really no vendor control over what's happening in the bidding. We quite like to have the vendor come up to behind the box, whether it be at our Melbourne complex or here in Sydney or up at Scone at White Park. And that is because we can help the vendor. If we haven't had a chance to talk to them, if that's the first time we've been able to catch up with the vendor, we can give them obviously our opinion. But we would ask them first and foremost, you know, now, have you got a reserve? Obviously, sometimes you have to sell. In the instance that it might be a foal share, the rules of a foal share normally are that the horse has to be placed on the market. But secondly, you might be in a position where you've raised the horse, but you have to sell it. You know, you have to get some cash flow back in. So what we need to know is A, what the lowest price is you'll accept for that horse. You know, unfortunately, there have been circumstances where someone might walk in and say, oh, look, you know, my reserve's 30,000, and we'll get to 20,000, we're about to put the horse out because we can't get any further, and the vendor will turn around and say, oh, look, I'll take that. The way the auction rules are set up in our industry, the auctioneer has the right to bid one or more times and to assist the vendor to get the horse up to reserve. So we can assist you in getting the horse up to reserve. So from time to time, that will be our bid that you're hearing being called. So it's important to, A, understand what is the lowest price you'll take for the horse. And that's, you know, the auctioneer will be standing there speaking, but beside the auctioneer will be normally the next auctioneer that will be selling. So whether it's one of the boys or Steph, they'll be saying and communicating with you, saying, you know, are you hard on that reserve, or would you take a little less if we get close? Now, obviously, we'll be trying to get way past your reserve, but if things get, you know, dicey towards the end, if there's only one bidder on it, you may have to make that decision whether you're prepared to take a little bit less.
And of course, the auctioneer, I really admire you guys. The auctioneering is unbelievable. I've done a few charity auctions and things like that, but nothing on a par of what you guys do. And as far as the auctioneer's job, it's more than just talking about the horse, and obviously you have your bid spotters out there, but it's a real selling tool, isn't it?
Oh, look, I think there's a lot to go into auctioneering, and of course, you know, experience is a great thing, and I think we're fortunate to have some very good auctioneers working for the company. I think one of the most important things about the art of auctioneering is not saying too much. I mean, everyone's got a catalogue. Most of the buyers there are professionals. They don't really want to hear everything about what's on the page. That's, you know, of no interest to them. They're sitting there about to buy or invest in something that's very important to them. So while we will, you know, give the basic details of the horse coming in, and if there's an update, of course we'll mention that. So, you know, as vendors, don't expect us to spend a minute, you know, introducing the horse. What we want to do is give the pertinent points, you know, if they have certain physical attributes that are really important, we feel, to express at the time of the sale, we'll certainly do that. But I think the art of auctioneering is, first of all, knowing the horse's value. And at the end of the day, that's our job, to get the horse up to its value and hopefully beyond. And so, you know, from time to time, we are selling horses off no reserve. So it's important for auctioneers to know what the horse is worth. Secondly, I think it's very important to, you know, start off nice and slowly, because I think it's very important to get people involved in the bidding process. From time to time, you know, I've been to other auctions and seen, you know, auctioneers race horses up to the reserve, and then of course, you know, there's no one sitting there waiting to have that one last bid. I think it's very important to get people involved in the bidding process. Once they're involved, there's every chance that they'll have another one, because they're actually, you know, they've got skin in the game. And they're emotionally involved as well. So I think that's important. So don't be concerned if your reserve's, you know, 50,000, we're starting at 5. It doesn't matter where we start, it's actually where we finish. We're doing that for a reason, to get people involved in the process. And there's nothing better than seeing 3 or 4 different spots around the ring actually having bids coming, because it gives people confidence to have a bid. And I suppose the last thing is, you know, We don't stop when we reach reserve. The whole idea is, you know, to try and get the horse to its value, and, you know, if it's possible to get, you know, to squeeze that buyer one more time to get that one little bit of extra money for you, that's what we're trying to do. To a point. I mean, there's no point hanging around. If there's no more bids coming, of course, we knock the horse down, we move on to the next.
Wow, I could hear a pin drop, couldn't we? Well, we've almost come to the end, so it won't be too long before we can have a glass of vino over there. But if we can just get the panellists that were here before, Jonathan, Mark, and also Peter O'Brien, to come up, and the English fellas as well. Now, if there are questions on the floor, we can hand the mic, or you can yell.
We have got another mic. I think Bonnie or Dean might just take the mic around. And look, you've heard a lot of information tonight, and I know there's been a lot of words spoken, but hopefully, you know, there have been snippets there that have been of interest to you. Would anyone like to ask the first question?
I think Les over there.
Les over there. Bon, Les just... there's a microphone coming around for you, Les. Of course, just a reminder, if anyone is viewing the streaming that we're doing tonight, if you'd like to... Dean, are we doing it on text or...?
I've already got a couple of questions.
Oh, I've got a couple of questions, Bon. Okay, so, yeah, are they doing that by text, or how if they're viewing online?
They just write. On the right-hand side of the page, there's an area, it says to chat with other participants.
Okay, so to chat with the participants, just write your question if you're viewing online.
All right, Les.
I would just like to ask a question of Jonathan regarding x-rays. My understanding always was that x-rays of yearlings were more meaningful than x-rays of weanlings, because the horse is that much older and it's a bit more mature, and you're not likely to see as many little things come up. Is that a fair observation, or would you disagree with that?
No, I think there's certainly some elements in that. And as I alluded to before, probably the two main categories of changes that you see on x-rays are, one are developmental problems, and the other are actual disease processes that occur. And in that developmental process is actually part of the just natural maturity of the weanling. So, and at that age, you know, when we're x-raying them at, you know, 5 to 8 months, they're certainly far from skeletal immature. So predicting what's going to happen is a lot more difficult, and particularly when that comes also to the OCD condition as well. They're at that age, between 5 and 8 months, there are certainly weanlings that have the disease. There are also weanlings that have the disease that in the next 4 months will heal on their own, and their horses as yearlings, we didn't even know had them, because we hadn't x-rayed them till they were yearlings, and so they actually heal. But conversely, there are also some horses at that age that appear normal, and they'll develop, particularly stifles, they'll develop stifle problems at the ages of 10 and 14 months. So you're right, it's a lot more problematic reading weanling x-rays compared to yearlings. And I think there's also a lot more experience and knowledge out there about yearlings than there is weanlings at the moment.
Next question from the floor. So now we have some. I can't see on the back there.
I was just wondering if there's any rule of thumb from a broodmare's perspective where of a first foal or third or fourth foal. I've heard that the first foal's usually not as strong as probably the latter foals. I'd just like to hear your opinion on that.
Yes, a good question. Generally, the first foal can be a little bit smaller, and that's largely due to it's the first time that the mare has actually carried a foal. So the space inside and as she is letting down into a brood mare is smaller. But they may be born a fraction lighter, but they soon catch up. And generally, I've always found that first foals are the foals that'll always make the most progress out of a group of foals, because they, as soon as they're born and they're out, they start progressing, and then when they get weaned, they really start to roll along. And also sometimes the mare is—it's her first time of lactating and so forth, so she mightn't be, you know, have a great volume of milk and so forth. So the foal mightn't be getting quite the amount it should be, but as soon as it's weaned, they can really kick on. So as far as that, it's not a problem. They generally catch up.
Got two, Simon. You know what? Any others from the floor?
Yep, Karen.
Thanks very much. Oh, hello. I just have a question about a breeding strategy. Say you're sending your brood mare to a new season first season stallion, and you get the resultant foal which you're happy with, and you want to breed your mare again in the next season. The idea of going back to that first season stallion, on the theory that if the first foal turns out to be a two-year-old or a winning horse, or it might sell at the sale, you might double down and increase your chances of getting a better return, whether it's on the racetrack or at the sale, by going to the same stallion as distinct from going to a different stallion the second time.
That is a very good question. It's a question that has been asked before in the paddock. We might get a couple of views on the panel. Look, first of all, there are some very good points and reasons to do that. Obviously, you'd be breeding back to the stallion if you were happy with the produce. So that, once again, you think, OK, well, the mare and the stallion have nicked to produce the correct sort of type, and if you're wanting to replicate that, that's not a bad way to do it. The thing I would say is there is a risk, as we know, in the commercial sphere for second season stallions. We have a saying within the industry that 8 out of 10 stallions fail. Now, we've got an outstanding group of stallions. We've just seen the first progeny sold, and you turn around and you think, well, how can 8 out of those top 10 stallions fail? But that is the industry standard. You know, in 5 years' time, probably 6 or 7 of those horses won't have yearlings coming to an Easter yearling sale. So there is a risk, and of course, we are so much governed by the success of the two-year-olds. So this season, you've got horses in that two-year-old range, like Striker, like Hinchinbrook, Star Witness. Now, these horses earlier on probably, you know, didn't have a lot of success in December, January, and just in the last 3 or 4 months have really hit their strides. I mean, Star Witness had a stakes winning double the other day. You know, he's up to four or five individual winners. Hinchinbrook's had 2 winners this week, including a most impressive winner on Wednesday at Canterbury. So suddenly, you know, the horses become popular again. So Northern Media was one who did it. Red Ransom, I remember, you know, you couldn't give them away early on in their second season. So there is a risk, even though those stallions made it, there's a risk that, you know, when you're selling progeny of unproven second season stallions, you know, you've got to take that into account. One of the breeders might like to make comment. Peter?
I just be conscious, be wary of, with a young mare, sending her to, for example, a same stallion 2 years in a row, or even 3 different stallions in her first 3 years that are unproven. I would generally, personally, try and, within the first 3 foals of the mare, make sure it's at least she goes to 1 proven stallion. So she has, you're taking that risk factor out. And there's plenty of proven stallions in a range from 10 to sort of 25,000 that are a great, very good workman-like horses that can, at least you've got a greater chance of producing a racehorse.
Pete, I'm interested to hear you say that, and I'd agree, and it's something that I, in fact, didn't include in my presentation, but I am a great supporter of, in fact, sending maiden mares to precocious-type stallions that can get you an early runner. Now, if you'd eventually like to breed a couple classic horse a little later in the mare's career, by all means do so. But initially, if you're breeding commercially, I think it's very good advice to go to a horse that can get an early comer, and obviously a proven stallion is beneficial in that regard too. Even if it's a first-season stallion, yes, I agree, there's no guarantee they're going to succeed, of course, but at least if you do go to one of those precocious type horses that you expect to get an early comer. I think it's advantageous for your mare to get those progeny out there, and if they are successful, then you can make the horse to a horse that perhaps might take a little time or get a little more distance. And again, I agree with what you said about you do only have between that foal, the first foal being born and your mating, and as James just reminded me, you only have a small window of opportunity. There are only a small number of two-year-old races for that two-year-old that you've sold that was a very nice horse, the first foal of that mare, to get out there and run. So it's not like it's going to be massively advantageous necessarily for you to sell that second progeny by the first season sire, but from the first foal, unless that first foal has come out and run, of course. But again, there's only a small time between the start of the two-year-old career and when you're going to sell the second progeny out of that mare.
Maybe a couple of online questions. In relation to getting yearlings and weanlings through sale time, what can handlers do to help these young horses as it is a highly stressful time for them? That is from Ashley.
Hello, Ashley. I think just I think Mark would agree as well. It's just a more... I was just thinking when I sat down, like little things, like there's all the new stables nowadays have these swing feeders where you can basically not go into the horse's box all day if you didn't need to. Personally, I don't like them. I like everyone, the lads going in and out of the stables, even just to feed them. So you're having someone in the box with the horse. It's and the more time you can spend with the animal, particularly as alluded to earlier on, and Sam did as well, I think hand walking is getting less and less on a lot of farms, and I think that's to the detriment of the horses, and the more of that you do, the more manageable your animal will be.
Obviously, also, the earlier you can handle your foal and educate your foal, taking it forward into weaning, onto yearling process, and continuing that regular uniting of the handler with the horse is also going to help, so there's not the gap in between where the horse hasn't been handled and so forth, and that's going to help the handlers in the long term.
Yeah, I think with even what Peter was talking about, the point of contact with a horse and regularly having that point of contact, they build more confidence with you. So that lessens danger, the dangers are, that you can avoid. So I think, the more you do with them, the more the confident they are around you, and you get a better result for you, yourself, and the horse.
In regards to pedigree, will a placed mare be more looked down upon than that of an unraced mare?
Probably a tricky one, Bon, to answer. So thank you very much, Jonathan. That's the fastest handball I've seen, I believe. Look, the situation when we do sit down and do pedigrees, as I said when Rusty and I were speaking, we spend a lot of time discussing all features of a pedigree. So we whilst we don't try and isolate things in a massive degree, look, a placed mare is obviously a mare that at least had the ability to get to the racetrack, which is important, and there was and thereafter she was able to be placed. So we are obviously from a normal tiering system, your Group 1 winners start at the top and you work your way down through your stakes winners, through to your metropolitan winners, through to your winners. Probably the one thing that is something that we do probably don't like very much, trying to avoid as much as possible, are mares that are in fact unplaced, mares that have been to the races and have not been successful in actually finding their way into the prize money. So unplaced mares are pretty much a bit of a no-no. Unraced mares, well, we probably consider them alongside of mares that have been placed and mares that might have won one provincial country race and that we don't record a metropolitan win. So certainly from a placing viewpoint, I don't think it's a serious negative in any way. As I said, I'd probably rate it alongside of an unraced mare, because unraced mares, we don't know whether they might have been, the dam of black caviar and suffered an injury. So, it's things like that we take into consideration. So, placed mares, I think they're okay.
Any others in the room as well? One at the front here.
Just wondering, for the young people coming through the industry, like for picking your stains, going around pin hooking and then picking your brood mares, what would be the best way to gain experience, both nationally and internationally?
Good question. I don't know how you... I think the best way is to get as much information as you possibly can from people that are experienced. So for any person that's young and getting and wants to get involved, there's always times, there's always sales, there's always people going around. Most of the people that are professional in this industry, I've found, have been remarkably free with their passing on their opinions. I don't think there's no clandestine aspects with it. I think that if somebody here wants to have a chat to Peter O'Brien about the feeding regime that goes on at Sedgen Ho, Pete's more than happy to sit back and explain it. And I think as an industry, we've been remarkably open and prepared to help and assist each other. So from an English viewpoint, the way that we do it is that if any young person came to us and said, look, you know, I'd like to get more involved, regretfully, there's not a lot of positions become available at companies like Inglis, because the people that are there love it, and we cherish our positions. But we are very happy to have young people walk around a sale yard with us, where we can sit back and talk to them about pedigrees, talk to them about confirmation. And I know that there's a number of bloodstock agents who are also very prepared to do that as well. So I think if you're really keen to get involved, be very free with yourself by presenting yourself to people and asking them whether you're able to join them on either being on stud farms or walking around sales complexes, chatting with everybody. The more information you've got, the more you're going to learn.
Yeah, and I think also there's such great opportunities to travel internationally and work on farms or with bloodstock companies. So and the opportunities are there. It's just a matter of sourcing them out. And as Simon was saying, agents are only too willing to help out. We here at Inglis's, if anybody would like any assistance or to discuss pedigrees and so forth anytime, any of us would be happy to sit down and go through that process. But I think it's if you've got the dedication and the will and want a career in the industry, it is a fantastic industry. I joined the industry straight out of school and was fortunate enough to work at a farm in New Zealand, and I just progressed through that way. But it was a great experience, and I've been overseas, and it is honestly a great career, the horse industry.
Thanks, Sam. Any others from the floor? Bonnie has another.
A question has actually come in for Dr. Lumsden on Twitter. Hashtag Ask Inglis. In general, OCDs in the stifle worse than the hock in regards to racing performance? So I think they've been limited there by the characters a little bit.
Yeah, it's a good question. And on a whole, I would say, the OCDs, they're right. The OCDs in the stifles on a whole certainly have the propensity to be worse than the hock. I mean, the typical OCD lesions that we see in the hock are generally not on a major weight-bearing surface. And so for that reason, it means that the joint's fairly forgiving. The cartilage heals fairly well, particularly after they've had surgery, which the majority of them will need. And typically they'll go on and cause minimal problem to the horse later on, both as a yearling and also then as a racehorse. The stifle conditions have the propensity to be more extensive and are in a more weight-bearing surface. So particularly, and there's some good information on the size of the OCD that you have, and useful categorisations as to the size of the lesion and the effect that it'll have in terms of causing lameness and performance. And because those stifles can potentially be bigger and more weight-bearing, there's the potential for them to be more serious, so yes. But they're all, as the horses are individual, the OCDs are also individual, so you've got to treat them like that. So.
Thanks, Jonathan. Any more from the floor? Gentleman in front, Bonnie.
My question is about service fees. To what extent are they set in stone, or is it useful to try and organise or to negotiate some sort of a discount?
I would certainly urge anyone, any breeder who's looking to breed to any stay in this year, to go and speak to the stud involved. Now, what we're finding is, as we discussed earlier, the first season stay-ins, the popular horses have booked out pretty quickly. Now, I know there's a couple of horses already in the Hunter Valley that you cannot get in a mare for love nor money. So, that shows that they've been well priced, and the breeders feel that they are horses that they want to support. But look, the likes of Cornmore, Darley, Whitten, Vinery, Arrowfield, they are all prepared to sit down and discuss your matings with them. Some of the studs are more rigid on their pricing than others, but certainly they'd love to sit down and talk about it. And negotiations always take place on service fee.
Just a lot of
farms, like if you have four or five mares, and the more mares you send to a farm, the better deal generally you get. So if you're if you concentrate and focus on one farm, generally you get a better deal.
You want to say something, Sam?
Just we can also help out if anyone wants any assistance in booking mares into any stallions. We're quite willing to help you in that process as well.
Hello.
Yep, that's working.
Given that we all, as vendors, want to go to the most commercial stallions, what do you think is the magic number for a book of a stallion? And do you think that they're probably stretched? Probably Pete.
So, Peter, you're asking how many mares you as an individual send to a particular stallion?
No, the full book of the stallion for the whole season.
Ah, yeah, okay. Is there an answer to that?
Given that you have three sales, major sales with 700 yearlings in each one,
yes.
Obviously we're just talking about how many stallions are full. Just it's a question to put out there. How many do you think is the magic number?
Well, if you had John Massara, he'd say 250, I guess, is the magic number to his stallions or any other major stud master. Yeah. But interesting question. I understand where you're coming from. What you're saying is you really don't want a flood of yearlings by one particular stallion in any sale. That's one of the difficulties, I think, that we encounter when we're doing our yearling sales selection. We want to take as many by the leading sires as we possibly can, but we realise there's a limitation, and we do want to have a variety of stallions in our sale. So it's a little bit of a tricky one, but I think perhaps what I mentioned in my talk that sometimes you're perhaps better to go to a slightly lesser stallion where you will be top of the tree if your mare is not an A1 mare, rather than send your A3 mare to the best stallion in the land. And it's likely that top stallion is going to have a big number of yearlings in the sale. I'm not sure I can answer that question categorically with a fixed number. Jonathan, in Easter, which you encounter far more than I, what's your ideal number for yearlings in a major in Easter yearling sale by the leading stallions?
Look, I think each stallion is an individual. Obviously, you know, the most we've ever had by any stallion is around that 60 mark, and I think Rusty and Simon spoke of it earlier. What you'll find is that, you know, the bottom 10, 15, 20% of that group are going to be discounted, because people who want to go there and buy a Fastnet Rock or buy a Redoute's Choice, they're going to look at all of them and they're going to say, okay, well, that's the best one, that's the next best one, that's the next best one. When they get down to the bottom 10, you know, they're not going to figure in, you know, what the horses that they want to buy. So, look, it's difficult. It's something, as Peter alluded to, we try and suggest to breeders, if we feel you're going to be at the bottom end of one of those stallions that's going to have 30 or more yearlings in a catalogue, we try and suggest going to the next level of sale down, because what you find is, you know, that horse stands out at a premier sale, or the horse that's going to be in the bottom end of the premier sale, that horse stands out at the classic sale. So I know a lot of breeders in the room would agree with that. In the old days, there used to be 60, and you couldn't buy a Son of Biscay or Bletchingly. These days, we are blessed to have, you know, so many of these stallions covering good books of mares. But unfortunately, from a breeding point of view, you can get a little bit unlucky. And Peter made the point: be very careful that you're seeing a mare of sufficient quality to, you know, the stallion. Because if you don't, you are going to be at the bottom of your book.
Bonnie, I see a question over there.
Just want to know. Do you have ratings on the brood mares? Oh, sorry. Do you have ratings on the brood mares like you do on the foals as well?
We don't generally actually rate the brood mare. What we tend to look at is we look at the female pedigree as a whole. So you're basically looking at three generations of the pedigree. And so when we go to score the horse, we're looking at the sire. We've already formed an opinion pretty much with where the stallion sits with regards to a commercial viewpoint. And then we look at the female pedigree. Now, the female pedigree is very much assessed by first, second, third generations, obviously. As a mare gets older, interestingly, a mare's race record, a great race mare, pick a Maccabi Diva, for example, once she gets up to foal number 5, 6, 7, or 8, her race record becomes less impacting on our decision. It comes down to more like how many foals she's had and things like that. So I don't think there's no specific way of rating a mare, because it's just, I think that would probably take too long, and we would probably go into some crazy formula of science that would not actually make sense, because as we all know in this business, horses will make fools and liars out of all of us all the time. So we're pretty much just trying to assess it in a fairly commercial viewpoint.
Any other questions from the tables? Bonnie, there's a gentleman down here.
I'm not sure why, but there seems to be a lot more fillies than colts at the weanling sale. Is there a reason for that?
Look, I think there is a reason. Any weanling sale, be it here or in Melbourne or on the Gold Coast, you're going to find that there's a percentage of the horses that are being sold because breeders don't want to take them through to yearling stage. They've made the decision that now's the time to sell them. They feel that for the time and expense that, you know, to take them through to a yearling stage, it's better to sell them as weanlings. And I think, you know, Sam and Peter alluded to that earlier. So that's the first and, you know, the number one reason. Secondly, of course, we heard Mark talk earlier about, you know, colts being, you know, the more popular horses at yearling sales. So breeders are hanging on to those colts that they feel are going to be commercial yearlings. So that's probably the second part of it. You know, basically, you know, they're looking at the reason for selling weanlings. Some of them, some of the nicer the weanlings here are being sold because they look the right sort of horses that can perhaps command a bit more attention as weanlings and get to cash flow earlier. You know, the Peter and Sam have been in the position where they've made decisions on what weanings to send. Pete, what are your decisions when you decide, when you look around your foals, which ones you're going to sell as weanings and which ones you're going to take them through?
We concentrate. I'd look at our weanlings and we concentrate basically Magic Millions and Easter. It's sort of the viewpoint. So when I look at our weanlings, the ones that I don't think are going to get in there are Melbourne, as a sort of fallback. I generally sell those. We have four foals here, three fillies and one colt. The fillies probably, they don't have the big pedigrees. They're by different stallions that maybe mightn't be through the roof next year, and it's just, but the main reason for me, they're probably sort of classic sale type yearlings next year. And that's why we'll be selling R4.
There's no doubt there are some opportunities there.
I suppose one thing too that has become popular and has framed the market a bit recently is the Asian market as well. You know, obviously Hong Kong, Singapore become very popular racing jurisdictions. And if you've got a trainer, you win a race on Randwick, you know, all of a sudden, as a 2 and 3 year old, all of a sudden the big offers come flowing in. So I suppose it all flows back to people would prefer to take colts to the yearling sale because a trainer's going to prefer to buy a colt because, you know, there's that pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, so to speak. So I suppose with those racing jurisdictions becoming so popular, it probably is leaning towards colts being more popular in the sale ring.
Now it is. Is there one more there up the back? Bonnie, did you see? No. All right. Well, I think thank you very much for joining us here this evening. And I think we've had a great feedback as well with the online coverage. We've got one more, do we, Bonnie? No.
Look, on behalf of Inglis, we would like to just present a small memento to our guest speakers tonight. I mean, they've given freely of their time and their expertise. So I think Tanita's got a couple of gifts. So thank you from my left, Dr. Jonathan Lumsden from REC. Mark Devsich from Henley Park, Peter O'Brien from Sechenhoe, and of course Caroline CSC, who once again has done a sensational job. Ladies and gentlemen, if you've got any other questions to ask, we're all going to hang around and have a drink. There's some nice food being offered around, so please join us. Best of luck if you are investing in mares or weanings on the weekend and into next week. Best of luck with your purchases. As we've all said tonight, we're here to assist you, not only tonight but throughout the year. So, you know, don't be afraid to give us a call anytime. We'll look forward to seeing your success in our sale rings.